Hello and welcome to episode 7 of Shockwaves. I'm one of your hosts, Rob Galuzzo. Staring at me with love in his eyes and a red stripe in one hand.
Nothing but love.
It's Elric Kane.
The deep end of horror.
The deep
end.
Saying it in his trailer voice.
My Eli Roth trailer voice. My Thanksgiving voice.
Of course, and our third host, of course, the lovely Rebecca McKendry.
Lovely.
I'd challenge that.
Yeah, every once in a while.
Challenge.
Elric, we've got to be nice occasionally. Well, I'm going to try to
be nice.
You, Rob. That was sweet.
You work with her.
Yeah. We're going to be nice here. So it's funny. We're going to do things a little bit differently, as always, because, you know, we don't want to give the same show every week. We want to spice it up. It has nothing to do with the fact that Elric is leaving town and that we're doing this earlier than usual.
That's true.
But no, it was a fun idea that we would, you know, it's pretty early in this show's history, even though a lot of people know us from Killer POV.
Which won the Rondo Award. Still waiting on it.
Entertainment Weekly's top podcast of 2015.
That's right.
Not to blow smoke up our ass.
Not this show, though.
That was the last show.
It's early, yeah. So, but for the new people, we just thought it'd be fun to open up to you guys for questions. So both Elric and I opened it up to both Facebook and Twitter to see if you guys had any, you know, things you were curious about.
We're going to do it rather rapidly.
Rapid fire.
As much as our brains can do it. I got a good one from Sean Vandiver from Twitter.
Yep.
If there was one movie you can go back in time and watch for the first time on the big screen, what would it be?
So,
take in the context, okay?
Yeah, got it.
Right. Oh, yeah, I know what yours is.
Yeah, of course.
You know? Do I even have to ask, or should I let the audience fill in the blank?
Yeah, no, I mean, you know, that's the thing is you hear these stories about, you know, what these films were like to audiences of the time period. Yeah. And, you know,
we talk about a lot on the old show. Like,
oh, of course.
Whenever we can meet someone who saw it.
Who saw it originally.
Like, Steven Rebellas was incredible.
Yeah, so obviously for me, it's Psycho. I think it's fun. Like, you go on YouTube, you could find audience reactions to John Carpenter's Halloween.
Yeah.
And it's fun hearing people scream. But the interesting side point to the story I have is, so they made the movie, Hitchcock a few years ago, which is about the making of Psycho.
Right.
And, Ryan Turek, who you guys know from the show, who will be on later, he was at Shock T Drop at the time. He had the opportunity to do the set visit and he gave it to me. He's like, hey, do you want to go do the set visit on Hitchcock for me? And just by sheer coincidence, there were, several days that I tried to go and every one of them, for whatever reason, the schedules couldn't line up. So I went on the last day of shooting when they were shooting the recreation of the premiere of Psycho.
Oh, okay.
So it was as close, like I went to a theater in downtown LA. I'm walking up. I see right there on the marquee Psycho. I walk in and it's crazy. It was like tons of theatrical, it's the theatrical poster, but with the actors within the movie in place of them. I had pictures of it. I wrote an article and everything. It's part of my set report. It was as close as possible to actually going to the premiere. Because then, you know, then I got to watch some film, Anthony Hopkins as Hitchcock getting out of the limo and coming up. I like watched them film that whole scene. And I was like, well, I didn't get to be there in 1960, but it feels like I got to see it this way.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, super cool. What about you guys? Cool.
Mine would, I think I have two answers. Jaws, I would definitely, just because that one had such an effect on me as a kid, and that was just like watching it on VHS. That was one, and just hearing my parents tell stories about what it was like to see in the theaters. The cops are coming, guys. The cops are coming. But
we're way more gangster than we are. Our old show was just so uniform.
So urban.
We're doing this in like a dirty alley in downtown LA.
Yo, Becca, spit it, yo.
Yo.
I'm spinning tails, and my next one would be the Tingler. Totally gangster.
Oh yeah, you get the scene.
I've always, or even House on Haunted Hill, just because I feel like that's something that we're really lacking in theatrical screenings now is the gimmickry.
Yeah, it's fun.
And I loved how William Castle tried to bring in things like that. Like even John Waters with Smell-O-Vision. I just love elements like that. The Tingler, because it had the feel-o-vision where you're actually getting shocked, or, House on Haunted Hill because they had Emerjo, which was the name of the skeleton that they like slung down from the projection booth. But I've always wanted to see a movie where they have some type of gimmick like that.
I'm not sure if this is correct, but I thought the Cine Family, aka the silent movie theater in Los Angeles, I believe they do the Tingler every year, right?
And they do it. It's
Paula Hafey's husband.
Boyfriend.
Jordan. Thank you. Jordan, that sets it up. And so he and Paula go in every year, but they only wire 5 seats. And I have been twice now, and I have not sat in one of them
yet. I might go this year. There's always so much on Halloween, so it's hard. But that's a film I'd love to see on Halloween.
Yeah. I want to see it where the entire audience gets shocked all at once. I think it would be amazing.
I would go a little earlier than cinema. I would probably save Abe Lincoln. Go to the theater. And I'd save his life, because you fuckers let him die. obviously I'd probably go.
Can I tell you a funny story about Lincoln just really quickly? Yeah. Tom Holland.
There's not enough Lincoln jokes.
Tom Holland, who wrote and directed, Child's Play, Fright Night, classic stuff. Anytime we get in a debate about actors, cause you know, some actors are nice, some are not so nice. He always would say to me, remember, an actor shot Lincoln.
That's great. I like
anytime we were talking about it, the questionable antics of an actor, he's always like, but just remember, an actor shot Lincoln.
Yeah, we're looking at you, AJ Bowen.
A very good Tom Holland impression, too.
Well, thank you.
But no, in reality, I mean, it's no question. It's Life 3, Island of It's Life. Like, it's to feel that in a cinema, the pulsating trial scene at the start.
Wait, that's two.
Part 3, Island of It's Life, is the opening scene is the big trial.
To experience Michael Moriarty's
The irony of my answer is probably that it never went to theatrical. It's probably a straight-to-VHS release. But if I had one, it would be Exorcist, only because I've never experienced a movie where people passed out and there was ambulances. That whole the stories around that are so interesting to me that I can't even imagine what it must be like to see it with an audience who hadn't seen it yet.
Yeah.
And them shrieking and fainting. I'm like, oh, that'd be so fun. Like, just it's everything I want in a horror film. I want to go to Conjuring 2 and people to do that. You know, people are scared in Conjuring 2, but it's not going to fuck your shit up. Do you remember that movie? It was Daryl Hannah and Dudley Moore, and they did an ad.
It was called People, something.
Yes,
People.
They had to do an advertisement for a horror film, and it looked like Exorcist. And it goes, this movie won't just scare you; it will fuck you up for life. And I always thought, that's so good. Like,
well, you know, it's a couple episodes when we had Mark Pavey on, which you haven't listened to yet, but he told the story that he would always convince his dad to take him to the movies, and he'll never forget. They went to go see John Carpenter's The Fog. Uh-huh. And, you know, in those days, it's not like advanced tickets. You buy tickets for the next show. So the doors were closed, and it was still the previous show. They're waiting in front of the line, and they heard screaming.
Yeah.
And his dad just turned to him. He's like, you sure about this? He's like, yep.
It's like a roller coaster.
Hear people screaming in the last greeting. So.
That's so true.
Super cool.
You want to fire one from Facebook, and then I'll...
Hold on, I didn't have it ready.
I'm
go
still
to the
looking
next
up
one.
This Dudley Moore movie because I used to love it when I was a kid, and it is called Crazy People.
Crazy People, yeah.
Because it was in an insane asylum. Yeah. Because they hired the inmates to write the ads. That was it.
This will be a quick one. Okay. This is John L. E. L. Tenney from Twitter. Says, what are the host's favorite films featuring characters who are psychic? Or films around ESP, PK, telekinetic.
Friday the 13th, Part 7.
Oh, hell yeah.
The New Blood.
That's pretty good. I'm glad that you just put that over Carrie.
That's the great noun. Well, the Rage Carrie, too.
Yeah. Oh, whoa. All right.
I'll go over everything except Carrie.
For some reason, I think you're going to answer Fury. But
and Prom Night, too.
I do like The Fury, actually. Yeah. That's a really good
one. Oh, yeah.
But Fury's got some pretty good telekinetics. So.
Yeah, honestly, I think that there's probably some other ones that I would
They're very
go
different,
with.
Too. Like a psychic and a telekinetic are pretty
bold. Oh, God, Scanners 3. What am I thinking of?
Yeah, because you can blow some shit up. I really like that Fulci film, The Psychic, but it's pretty slow in comparison to Carrie's just a really kind of visceral, great little movie.
No, I'm trying. No, never mind. Hold on. That's not quite. Maybe Eyes of a Stranger. I like ones where they can see what the killer sees. There's also, and it's not well known, there's an Ali Sheedy movie called Fear. And I know, and you're like,
that.
Ali Sheedy? Yeah.
No, really. I used to love Ali Sheedy.
It's a great movie, and it's just called Fear, not the Wahlberg one, but it's her. Thank you, Elric, banging on his chest now. But yeah, it's Ali Sheedy, so and good. She plays, I think she calls herself an empath in the movie, which is apparently different. But yeah, and she can sense this killer that's going on. Oh, speaking of which, you know how we'd always talked about bringing a psychic on the show?
Oh, yeah.
My daughter goes to music class with a psychic, and she's always there, and she's like, oh, Blumhouse, I must work with you guys.
I'll hook it up.
We could get a psychic on the show now, guys.
Now, would we call the Conjuring and Insidious films, would we call Lin Shaye and the characters
Warrens?
In Conjuring? Well, the Warrens, would we call them psychics or empaths or...
She,
occultists.
Yeah, she likes the Insidious films because she immediately was like, oh, you mean the Insidious films? And I'm like, I had nothing to do with the Insidious films, hon, but I've still heard all about what's wrong and what's incorrect or what's right about them. So yeah, these are questions for her. So some night we will have to bring a psychic on.
I like it.
All right. You got one? Next you're going to be like, oh, let's do a live Ouija reading. Yeah, yeah, no, none of that. Sure. From Eric Fetchit on our Facebook page. He wanted to know, did you ever listen to the Dead Pit Radio podcast when they were doing episodes? And what other podcasts besides Shockwaves do you guys recommend?
I did listen to Dead Pit.
Yeah. I was actually a guest on their show once. I loved it. They were a good show.
That was, back when I was doing Fango Radio, and there was like, I'll call it like some friendly rivalry because Debbie ended up going on their show at one point, but there was a point where they made fun of D, and yeah, so I started listening to their show.
No, they wrapped up.
I think it wrapped, but I started listening to their show because of that. And plus they're from kind of the area, of Southern Virginia where I went to college. So like they were near there. I think they were Kentucky based, but because I knew the area they were from, I was like, this is awesome. I'm going to start listening to it. So yeah, it was a good show.
Any others would recommend you'd fire out?
Well, I've already said, you know, the Damn Fine Cast, which is the soundtrack one. You know, what's cool about that, if you're a soundtrack lover and subscribe to them on iTunes, the guys behind those have essentially started like they do the official one for Milan Records and Lakeshore, and they've folded them all into their one feed. Mm-hmm. So even, you know, like they just did a really great interview with Brad Fidel because of the Terminator. They just re-released the Terminator again. So that's always one of my favorites. And, you know, the usual ones, Brett Easton Ellis and Mark Maron for interviews.
Like, that's the problem with Brett Easton Ellis. I love the content, but it's like sometimes it feels like a month between shows or something. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah, yeah.
I listen to Neil deGrasse Tyson because I'm a nerd and absolutely love him. Like, in another life, I married that man. I could listen to him talk for hours.
He's a smart guy.
Yeah, I love him. And then I also like shows where they don't necessarily get into like the stories behind the stories, but they just tell ghost stories. So there's a couple of those that I listen to.
Yeah, I got to listen to Lore more.
That's one.
I've started a couple episodes of that. I listen to Projection Booth whenever it's a film that I'm interested in, and mm-hmm. I always really like them, but I can't listen every week because sometimes it's stuff you have no idea what it is.
Yeah, yeah.
And then one I've just heard recently, I've listened to about two or three, and I like it. Faculty of Horror. It's Alexandra West. I think you're friends with her.
Yeah, they pop up on my feed all the time.
Writers from Toronto, I believe, and they are kind of more academic, and mm-hmm. they just will take like one topic, like we're going to talk about shivers and sex and Canadian films. There are probably like 40 episodes by them, and the couple that I listened to are really cool, and she just wrote a book about French extremism, which came out like a week ago. So as the first person to write a book on the horror French extremity, I think it's the first major one published, but they might not be major. Yeah, this looked like pretty expensive. Anyway, those are fun ones.
Yeah, that's cool. Got any more from Twitter?
Well, with Mr. Ken Hanley, who now pretty much owns everything Fangoria. He has Fangoria sweaters, t-shirts, socks.
He owns
it all now. He asked us about 10. So I'm going to just pick
10 questions,
a couple quick ones here. I like this one. Most fucked up film you'd recommend a stranger. Like right now, a stranger comes in off the top of your head, some crazy movie that you'd tell them, oh, you got to see this.
Okay. So I am at Phoenix Comic Con last week and this woman comes up to me and she's telling me about how she really likes horror that affects her. Uh-huh. And she's telling me that she really likes a lot of French films because of that and asked for recommendations. And I recommended Fat Girl. Oh, yeah. Oh. And then, and I also recommended, there was another one that I was, Taxidermia. Cause she was like, I like things that kind of are repulsive, but really affect me. So I recommended Fat Girl and Taxidermia. And as soon as she walked away, Dave looks at me and he's like, I can't believe you recommended Fat Girl to somebody you've never, she's going to go home and she's going to think you're the most crazy person.
Yeah.
Fat Girl for me.
I think the funny thing about this question is more like, what's fucked up to you? Cause there isn't much that, like, besides like Martyrs and maybe three or four other titles that I think are fucked up.
Yeah.
There aren't many films that I view that way.
No, I mean, I guess I'd have to talk to the person and get a feel for what they consider fucked up. Mm-hmm. But if it had to be just one off the top of my head, it'd be Angst, which, you know, is our recent discovery of the last year.
But yeah, you're right. I mean, fucked up is kind of a very personal thing because now that I think about it, Fat Girl isn't even a horror movie.
Well, you know, but you, yeah, I mean, it's fair in the same way Irreversible
right.
would fall into that category. That's
fucked which is fucked up.
Yeah, that would be something I might even recommend.
I'd recommend Dead Alive to everyone.
Yeah.
And that's the thing is like some people will love that but some will consider it fucked up.
Yeah. No, you know? I think that's a hard one to answer. Maybe, you know, Funny Games, the original, in that same vein of it's like, oh, this is fucked up, but it's interesting and makes you think a little about form and narrative.
Yeah, I'm more hesitant. Some of the things that I consider, even though none of us like the phrase guilty pleasure, like the movies that I know are pretty polarizing, I feel worse like recommending those to people if I'm kind of like, you know what, you might want to try The Forest because it's got some good moments. If they come back and they're like, that was the worst fucking movie I've ever seen.
Right.
Those are the ones I'm more kind of nervous about.
Right.
I will file one fire up because it's a fun one from him. Follow up. If you could interview one deceased horror filmmaker who's passed, who would it be, assuming they came back to life and did podcasts?
For me, it's Perkins. Uh-huh. And I mean, technically most people know him as an actor, but I'm just so fascinated. He only did two movies as a director, and I'm just fascinated by what he did on those two movies, including Psycho 3. So
yeah, that's a good one.
Great to talk to him.
Doris Wishman.
Oh, yeah, that'd be fun.
I've always wanted to interview her, and she passed away kind of right as I was getting into kind of the point where I could have asked her for an interview. And yeah, I wish I had had that chance.
All right, nerds, get your boners ready because I'm about to drop it. I would do a sit down commentary, 2-hour commentary with Stanley Kubrick watching The Shining. Fuck all you haters, including my friend Mick.
Because he would totally do that.
But I think that would be pure gold to literally sit down with Stanley Kubrick and talk for 2 hours watching The Shining and hearing what he would say. Oh, yeah, that thing that took us for fucking ever. We had to build the whole fucking hotel with the lights and the, you know, because he's like a New York Jew that people forget that about him because he ended like the last 40 years in England in kind of isolation. But they forget this was like a New York, Brooklyn Jew who like just, I know he had a vision, man. He was on the street taking photos, man. Got, you know, I don't know. I think that'd be a lot of fun.
Yeah.
So thanks, Ken Hanley, for that vision. Question.
I got a bunch of quick fire ones from Facebook here. Let's see. Jeff Fremis on Facebook says, single best horror sequel of all time that blows all others out of the water. Whoa. That for me would be Maniac Cop 2.
El Gustavo is just waiting to watch it.
It has a wrap, people. A wrap.
And that's why that's just like the cherry on the top of why that movie is amazing. It's so much better than the first.
I've got one for you, Ryan Turek. Get ready for it. It's coming just for you, baby. Welcome, Fright Night Part 2.
You are a madman.
That movie is
You're a crazy
fantastic.
Person.
One day, okay, one
guys,
day, that's going to be on Blu-ray.
I own this on VHS. You guys should come over and watch it sometime.
No,
just
not
so we
on
can
VHS,
validate.
No,
we're not watching
okay, actually,
VHS.
No, sorry. I'm canceling my entire answer when you said, when you reminded me, blew the other one out of the water. It does not blow the other one out of the water.
Yeah.
But it comes very close and is a great movie. It definitely doesn't blow it out of the water. I'm with you on that.
Luke Galeozzo. It looks like my name, Galeozzo.
Is this your long-lost twin?
Maybe. This is for you, Elric, because I don't think Becca and I can answer it. Favorite Australian/New Zealand horror films?
Yep, I could.
Oh, you could?
Yeah, well, it's just because Dave did
Australian?
He did a big Ausploitation thing, so.
All right, well, go ahead
What
and
would
answer.
You pick?
I would definitely, I love Day After Halloween, also known as Smash.
Oh, I want to see that.
Snap Cut? What is it? Snapshot, that's it. Because it's got this great opening song where it's, and it's a snap. Yeah, it's wonderful.
I mean, there's obviously Brain Dead, which is what it'll always be called to me, Dead Alive. Yeah. How I saw that as a kid blew my mind and bad taste. But New Zealand hasn't got a lot of obscure ones. There's one called Death Warmed Up. That was the first kind of punk splatter thing done. In New Zealand, years and years ago, I gave it my only copy to Elijah Wood when he was on Inside Horror. And I didn't have the balls to ask him when he was on, hey, did you ever watch that? Because I didn't want to make him feel bad when we met him again.
Like, I gave you my one
copy. I gave him my one copy of this crazy, weird splatter movie. But I would say, you know, in terms of best, I think Babadook now really stands out as like the most polished, with Housebound kind of short, quick, close behind.
Patrick's
the recent
great
movie.
Too.
Patrick's really
cool. Patrick,
And then there was that one set in the retirement village in Australia, and I had the retirement home, and the name just totally, it always escapes me. This is a movie directed by Tony Williams. Oh. So if you need to look it up, look up Tony Williams. It's all set in a retirement home, and old people are being killed, and it's like arty in slow motion and weird, but. And then, hey,
I think it was in your the elderly article you did in
oh,
the,
um,
the old people at the home.
It's not,
yeah, I keep wanting to say burnt offerings, but it's not.
No,
but also I think, you know, the
strange behavior is that the one?
It's like that, but it's
strange
not.
Strange behavior is
and
Road Games
is American, is awesome. But in a sense, but the you know the it's a great fun.
Richard
film.
Franklin, yeah. Man,
there's and a lot of good Aussie. Too.
Plus any of the like alligator ones, like even going back to
Dark Age,
going through with Rogue, Blackwater. I love those.
I've been hearing really cool things actually when I was in Australia about the Wolf Creek TV show, which I still haven't seen.
Yeah.
But I didn't know what the story is. Do you know what it is?
No.
It got me so much more, because I'm just thinking, oh, more of him just going around killing people. The idea is an American family go through there. He kills all of them in a camper van except the girl. And basically the whole thing is her going, you know what? I'm going to hunt this motherfucker down and kill him.
Wow.
And so it's about her revenge story. And I'm like, oh,
that's
I'm in.
Yeah, that's
like,
pretty good
to me. So somebody told me that while I was there and I got so much more interested in
you know what it is? I can't figure out how to watch it here in America because there's 10 episodes, I think.
Yeah.
And it's on, I looked it up once and it was on a network I'd never heard of.
Mm.
And I'm like, wait, but are they all out now? Like all 10? Is it air? I got to figure out how to watch it here.
Now, did you go to one of the Wolf Creek bars while you were over there?
I did. Well, actually, no, we were at one bar. They're all kind of that, but we weren't in as quite a remote area. I've been once to somewhere almost as remote as some of that stuff.
But they have actual Wolf Creek themed bars.
Oh, I didn't
now.
Know that. Yeah.
Yeah. I think they call them pop-up bars.
Call them pubs in Australia. They're all Wolf Creek.
No,
bars.
Camilla did an article on it on Blumhouse, and it was about these kind of like pop-up bars where it will just pop up and it's these Wolf Creek themed bars where everything in it will be Wolf Creek themed.
Here's a deep question. I don't know if any of us will be able to answer it.
Okay.
It's Becky Belzil, who was on Twitter.
Recognize her?
Yeah, and she asked, you know, because I think she's looking for deeper connections to movies, but which films affected you most profoundly, example, made you question something around yourself, your life, or the world around you?
I have an article going up tomorrow on this, which will be up long before
2 weeks?
Tomorrow. Yeah. So it's going to be up for 2 weeks tomorrow. I have an article going up called 10 Science Fiction Films That Changed My Life.
Mm.
So wow, nicely coincided. I will say Cube, Mourn in Flames, and Galaxy Quest.
Aren't they more sci-fi though?
Yeah, I did sci-fi in that. Horror movies that made me change my life.
Or just made you question things. I think
that's a tough call.
Yeah.
I was deeply affected because, you know, I like the true, you know, I like reading about true crime, but it really is upsetting. Like, I like horror because it's escapism, and I tend to like stuff that falls in the fantastical. Right. Or, you know, stuff like The Conjuring. That's just fun. Like, I believe in paranormal. But it's like, I remember being deeply affected by, like, Henry Portrait of a Serial Killer when that first came out and watching that on video. Cause, like, you know, I was in the slasher cycle watching Freddy and Jason movies, and then you see that. It's the first time you see Michael Rooker. So he's like this fresh face and he's great in it. And it's like this weird, it's just like, I guess it makes you realize, like, man, there's some evil in this world that has nothing to do with, you know, horror movies.
Yeah, there's a real one that's very topical to right now that it's kind of horror light, but it's really intense. We need to talk about Kevin.
Oh, God. Oh, yeah.
Tilda Swinton, but it's so like what's happening in America
it's
right now
Netflix
with shooters.
It's streaming right now.
Yeah, it's an intense portrayal.
Yeah, it's crazy.
But I mean, I guess that can also mean, like, I felt a little different, like, Irreversible, and there's some movies that kind of hollow you out for a few moments and make you just kind of go, ugh.
The end of, and this is weird because it was kind of existential, but the end of Cemetery Man was like that for me, where they realize there's nothing out there. And that was, which somehow does not blow the movie. But yeah, that was like a moment for me where they sit down at the edge and they're just sitting there.
Yeah, I wonder if anyone watches like a movie like An Exorcist or something and actually, you know, changes religion or changes their beliefs just from a movie. It must happen over time. People who are really affected, but we watch so many movies, I doubt we're likely to have that dramatic an effect on us. You know?
Yeah, if I have those things, it comes from other genres usually. Yeah. I get a lot from science fiction, which is why I'm writing the article right now.
And no one's talked about Possession yet, so. but I would say, like, the movie like that, those are the kind of movies that maybe changed my, view on, say, the genre, what it could be. Like, cause you go, oh, wait, this is a big domestic drama, intense, Kramer versus Kramer, and it happens to also be a horror film. So, and it doesn't change my whole life, it maybe changes my viewpoint on genre, so, which is fun.
Yeah.
This is, you know, I'm curious what you guys think of this one. This is from, George Fox Leak on Facebook. And he writes, I'm a huge horror fan, but not many of my friends or family are into it. So I often end up watching horror movies alone. How do you feel about the experience of watching a horror movie is altered by whether you're going solo or with company? And which do you prefer? Are there certain types of horror movies that you think benefit from being watched solo or with a group or vice versa?
I'd say that the majority of the horror movies that I watched up until I actually lived with, like, a guy were by myself because my parents were never into it. The majority of the stuff I watched in high school, I watched alone. And then even through college, I mean, my roommates were never into it. So it was always just me in my room, sitting on the edge of my bed, watching it by myself. I think that was, it definitely made me pay attention more. If I'd been in a room full of people, I feel like it would have been jokey and I might not have been as focused and attentive on the films as I was.
Yeah, it's a bummer because you do lose that little audience attention. I mean, we grew up with VHS, so we, unlike, even though we always fight for the theatrical experience, the reality is most of the movies we saw were at home in the dark on VHS, not in a theater. And all my favorite, unlike you, I watched a lot of them alone, but all my favorite memories are watching them with like one friend. You know, one person.
Yeah, that's right.
But my best memories, and probably the reason why I'll always love the Friday 13th movies is because my stepfather growing up was a Presbyterian minister, and he would watch every Friday. I don't know what it was about that particular genre, but every Friday 13th movie, he would sit down and usually be during the day and not at night because, you know, otherwise I'd probably be freaked out. I was probably like 12 watching all these movies. And he'd sit there and all you'd hear from the rafters every time someone got killed wasn't like, you shouldn't be watching this. This is outrageous. He would just go, oh, help. Oh, my gosh. Like, and he's got this high pitched, like Kiwi voice. And I remember it would end and he goes, I don't know if you should be watching that, Elric. Like, and he's like your stepdad, so he can't do anything to you. He had zero power over me. So it's just like that feeling of, you're sharing something. Yeah. And it's a little taboo, but it's also kind of fun.
Well, I miss watching the VHS, like you hit the nail on the head. If you have one or two friends, because you're young, you know you rented it and you're not supposed to be watching it. So there's that weird thrill that you're experiencing with somebody. But then, you know, like now as an adult, it's like we get to experience these theatrically, like at the revival houses. That's fun. But a lot of movies I tend to watch alone because it's like, I don't want to put anyone through like some of my tastes, like the Italian horror movies and stuff.
South Korean stuff.
You need to be a special kind of person to want to sit through those with
them. That's what's the cool thing about growing up with, and if you make a cinephile friend,
yeah,
that's somebody who will watch anything with you.
Yeah.
It's also kind of fun that you know which friends you're going to take to which films.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
Kind of like going to prom or something. You're like,
yeah.
Which will lead us to our final quick question because this is a really fun one.
Sure.
Somebody who writes for your site.
Oh.
It's three part, but it's all quick.
Three part.
Derek Faraci, Paper, Scissors, who wins? 1, 2, 3.
Oh, wait, I don't know the game.
Okay, one more time.
I'm going to just point, I'm going to point this out that Rob just brought a butter knife to a rock, paper, scissor fight.
He literally
put one finger out. He's like, how could I butter my skull?
So technically he would have won because Elric and I were both paper.
I'm
going to
have to change my psychology.
Yeah, okay.
1, 2, 3. Yeah, scissors, rock, paper.
Okay, got it.
1, 2, 3.
Oh, I kicked both their butts.
No, what happened is you were smashing me and he cut your throat with a scissors.
But that's, I'm wrong.
So, I know you won. So, as if anyone needed guess, to guess, Bekah defeated both of us with her hammer-like instincts. And then he follows it up with even more obscure, Freddie, Jason, Michael, who do you take to prom?
That was
my prom connection.
God, who do I take to the prom? Freddie, I guess.
I feel like Jason's the better dancer.
Michael always comes home. I'm going Michael, always comes home. And lastly, when will AJ Bowen be on the new show?
That's a good question.
If you're listening, AJ,
when
you
are you
decide.
Coming back on the show?
Yeah, AJ,
it's kind of up
when
to
are you.
You
coming back on the show?
Yeah, there you go.
That's next week, probably.
Yeah, probably now. You know. Anyway, that's where we go. I'm glad we can answer those.
Yeah, thank you so much for submitting those. We're going to check in with Ryan and then be back with some special guests.
Nice.
That's right. And we played that for a reason. I'm sitting here with the head of development at Blumhouse, Mr. Ryan Turek. Welcome back to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me back.
And we got to see...
You know what? This thing's working out. I like coming back week after week to just promote a cool movie.
Yes, it's pretty cool.
Yeah.
But we got to see John Carpenter in Los Angeles as of this recording. He's on tour now.
So good.
And all I have to say is if he's coming anywhere near you, you have to go.
Yeah, you have to.
I mean, you
really have to like find a way just to get a ticket. Because I feel like this is, you know, I don't know if he'll do this again. You know, I mean, like his tour schedule is really eclectic. I mean, he's traveling every day. He's literally doing the rock star thing.
Although he did cancel his Iceland show, which was the first one that was announced. And I was like, yeah, I never believed that he was going to go to Iceland.
Yeah. But he is traveling. I mean, he's traveling everywhere. You know, yeah. He was in Chicago and then he went to Portland, then he went to LA. And it's just like, dude, you're channeling the rock star god status right now.
Now that he's in the thick of his tour,
yeah.
I've never seen him more happy, enthusiastic,
right.
And just generally into it.
Yeah, I think the warm-up show, as some people are calling it, you know, I think that was, you know, him dipping his toes in the water, seeing what kind of reaction he's getting from the crowd. I noticed between the bootleg theater show and the Orpheum show, you know, his stage presence was much more magnified this time around.
I'm a big fan of the Carpenter dance.
The Carpenter shuffle. Yeah. The first show we were at, he just kind of stood there, hand in his pocket, did his thing. Every once in a while, he'd elicit a little, yeah, you know. But this time he was like shimmy and shaking, man. He was doing a little dance and, it was great. It was great. And I noticed that he rearranged his set a little bit. And I think, you know, that's just obviously, you know, I don't know why a musician would rearrange the set. I mean, I'm not a musician, nor would I pretend to be, but, he had rearranged some of the songs. You know, I think Prince of Darkness was
a little further along.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, you know, you get
but it's cool. It's super cool.
You figure out a groove of what you think will play better. And right. I mean, the reason we bring it up is not just for the music. Quite frankly, it's such a wonderful celebration of his filmography that if you're just a fan of his, like, it's worth it to see. Yeah. And I think the Lost Theme stuff live is like so much more rockin'.
It's a lot more powerful. I mean, like the Lost Themes as they are now, they're just great. They're great to have on in the background. You know, you turn up the volume, have them on in the background. And a lot of them, I mean, they're just kind of cool. It's good mood music.
Yeah.
The first Lost Themes, I didn't understand what the concept was because, you know, when he let slip at Beyond Fest a couple years back that he was going to do this Lost Themes thing, I had stuck in my head, oh my God, he's digging into the vaults and finding old themes from like Big Trouble in Little China. And I was trying to identify them. And then I'd be like, that's the Big Trouble track. And then he came out and he was like, no, this is just stuff I cooked up that's like all original.
Yeah.
So that kind of recalibrated my thinking on it. But, you know, they're really cool. It's really, I mean, like, I don't know if a lot of them are suited well to movies, but they're great just standalone tracks.
Gaspar Noé might disagree with you.
He's used a lot in love. Yeah, yeah. but it's all really good stuff. And he was, you know, he played the Orpheum crowd. There was a different energy than there was at the bootleg show. The bootleg show, you know, had some of the usual suspects in the audience, and Adrian Barbeau showed up. A couple of filmmakers. Orpheum was like a who's who. It was just like Brad Fuller was there, Neil Marshall was there, the Monster Squad guys were there, like literally
together
all rolling. Yeah. It was amazing. And then the energy in the crowd was just fantastic. We had a few fucking losers in the back that were making a little bit of noise, drinking a little bit too much. Just like, shut the hell up. But, you know, for the most part, the crowd was super respectful, so it was good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely check it out. If he comes near you, go see him. You'll not regret it. Oh, trust me.
And also that merch booth. Insane. I walked in not expecting to buy anything, there's so much merch at the table. It was like albums and new t-shirts. There was a Thing t-shirt with a cool design I'd never seen. It was a great Escape from New York t-shirt.
He knows our weakness.
I know. I was just like, son of a bitch. But yeah, he knows our weakness because the line wrapped through the Orpheum lobby into the reception bar area and doubled back a couple times.
I never made it to the merch booth. And I'm actually kind of glad.
I just want to give a shout out to Brian Collins, who I slipped 20 bucks and he got me a poster. So thank you, Brian.
Well done, Collins. Well done. All right. So what do you got for us? We're going to do a pick of the week. Sure.
Yeah. So usually I like to reach way back sometimes to find more obscure titles. And honestly, I don't think this movie that I want to talk about gets enough love. It came out during an era that we were seeing, you know, we were well into the sequel, Saw sequel business. Mm-hmm. Hills Have Eyes remake came out. It was like that era, Hostel and Hills Have Eyes and Saw sequels and the torture porn and all that stuff.
Sure.
And then
some mean times.
Yeah. And then crept up this little movie called The Ruins.
Oh, yeah.
And The Ruins came out through Paramount. Ben Stiller executive produced it, and it was based on a book by Scott Smith.
Yeah,
it was directed by Carter Smith. Carter Smith made some waves when he did a short film called Bug Crush. Mm. And The Ruins, you know, based on this book, is about a bunch of American tourists and one German tourist, I believe, who make it out to these old ruins where the locals are not too keen on you visiting the ruins once you step onto the property, which is surrounded by earth that has been salted so nothing can grow on it. Once you step onto the property, like, there's no going back. The locals don't want you to come back, and they're willing to go through very lethal methods to make sure you don't return. And there's a good reason, and it's because of the local vegetation is lethal. It's a dangerous vine. And basically it's crawling all over these, this temple ruins, and, our leads go there, and, you know, they get driven there, by the locals because they pissed them off. And they get stuck at the top of this temple. And over the course of a day or so, they just slowly start losing it. And the vine starts creeping up on them. And it's a cool little movie. I mean, I remember reading the book, and I was like, I have no idea how they're going to capture this intensity. And I think that Carter did an okay job with, you know, getting inside the characters' heads. With a book, obviously, you gotta figure out what's worthy of the screen, what's not. You know, what information's important and what's not. For the most part, he captured the relationships pretty well, I thought. He captured the threat level pretty well. And I think that's the only thing that's missing is the sense of surprise. And it might just be because I read the book.
Yeah.
But the sense of surprise and what the payoffs, I should say, are so delicious. You know, these vines are more than just the kind of vine that's crawling up the lattice on the side of your house. You know, they move on their own at a pretty quick speed. They're able to mimic certain things. And it just felt, I don't know, it's just a fun, weird, oddball movie. You know, it came out of a pretty important time in horror, where horror, the face of horror was changing, you know? Like, as you said, it was pretty mean, you know?
Yeah.
And things were evolving. We were getting more human threats. We were seeing a lot more human threats on screen. We had shifted. We were just edging into the supernatural, but it was all about your neighbor next door or the European tourist, or I should say the American tourists getting picked off by Europeans. you know, And so things were different, and then just comes along this little nature run amok movie. On a budget, no less.
Great actors. Sean Ashmore's in it.
Ashmore.
Jenna Malone. Yeah, I remember this. See, my thing was, I remember I missed it in theaters because somebody had told, I might have even been like Tony Timpone from Fangoria, is like, you have to read the book before you see the movie because the book is so good.
Yeah.
And of course, I never got to I own it, but it's one of those many books that I buy like in the pile that I never get to.
Yeah, of course.
So I finally I gave in and watched it on video, and I remember really liking it quite a bit, actually.
Yeah,
I thought it was super cool, especially considering the context
it's
of what was
different.
Going on.
It was a different movie for a different time, you know, and Joe Anderson's the other actor that's Lynn Ramsey too. But it was just something. It was like something a little different.
Yeah.
And you know, I mean, like, and the gore. I mean, like, you know, because it came out during a very extreme time for horror cinema. You know, Carter Smith didn't flinch on the gore aspects of it all. You know, some very bad things happen to people's legs in this movie, and the vines are pretty unrelenting. So there's a significant amount of gore and a significant amount of cringy moments, you know. I mean, I was rewatching it with my girlfriend, and she just turned around. She's like, "No, can't deal with that. Can't deal because there's a lot of flayed flesh."
Yes.
But it's cool. It's a cool little flick. I remember doing some of the press on it way back in the day, and Carter was showing off the kind of temple
that they had as a model. And then, like, it was just like a little recreation of the temple. And then I had like a little camp on top with the tents and stuff. And he said it was just really important to be able to give the sense of geography and where the characters were going. And when they stepped down from the temple to talk to, you know, the local villagers and try to get off the temple and stuff, it was just very important to have a sense of geography, obviously. And
right. Right. Really
important storytelling. But you know, they poured, it was a, it just felt to me like a very expensive studio experiment, you know? I don't think that movie would ever get made today.
Yeah.
You know,
I don't remember it doing well either.
I don't think
it
did. I don't think it did all that well. And it's a mixed bag, you know, in terms of critic reviews. It's on HBO Now or HBO Go right now. And I revisited it on HBO Now. And I was just pleasantly surprised by it. I was just like, this is such a weird little movie.
Yeah.
The ending's not very satisfying, but you know, I think it was a product of a lot of studio notes. But it wasn't as gratifying as the book itself, but don't let that, you know, bog the film down, because it's pretty cool.
Yeah, you know what, you convinced me. I want to recheck it out, because it's been a while and I remember kind of liking it when I saw it. So and I just picked it up on Amazon. It's not that expensive. You can get the Blu-ray for like $8.
Exactly. Yeah.
So not bad.
But it's one of those movies, you know. I mean, like 20 years down the road, you know, someone's gonna go, "Hey, remember when they did Ben Stiller EP'd that weird movie about vines?" Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So, check it out.
20 years is good to every horror movie. I know.
That's a different rant. I know. None of our opinion matters. In 20 years, what's gonna matter. Where the film lives 20 years from
exactly.
That.
Well, Ryan, thanks for dropping in.
Thank you.
Hang in there, guys, because we got the Soska sisters coming
on. Oh, I love them.
Yeah, and it's great, great fun chat, so lots of laughs. Stand by.
Keep the laugh in. I like the twin laugh.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen. We are laughing, and we are here with two ridiculously awesome guests.
Ridiculously awesome.
He's already on that.
I'm all right. It's all I have. That's literally all I have to talk to Canadians. That's all I've got.
I'd like to welcome Jen and Sylvia Soska.
Soska.
That's all of them. We're saying all of them. If I say it enough, one's going to be right.
Well, that was a proper Hungarian pronunciation.
Well, and there's a reason, because we briefly interviewed you guys for 10 minutes at Texas Friday Air a year or two ago, but on the old show.
I remember before, because I did your panel, and I remember before I went onto the panel that they actually had the press person come over, and they were like, "Have you met Jen and Sylvia before?" And I was like, "Yeah, we go way back." And she's like, "I just really want to go over with you the correct pronunciation of their last name," and she was like, Soska, and I'm like, Soska. Whoa. And she's like, Soska. So when I introduced you guys at Texas, it was like all types of shushing. Oh, yeah.
it stuck with Elric.
Bekah literally said to us that Sylvia will break you if you fuck up her name. Oh. So we're like taxi driver practicing in the mirror, just going, Soska, Soska, Soska. So we're fucking Hungarian.
My parents are probably crying with pride right now.
I know.
Are they? Cool. That's great. Are they listening?
That's amazing.
They will be.
Then let's forget that F word we just dropped. Let's dial it back.
Mom, I didn't swear yet.
No, just us. Just the lousy Kiwi and the American people. So that's cool.
Yeah. Ooh, you're a Kiwi.
I'm a Kiwi.
Wow.
It all makes sense.
Hey.
They just thought you were weird.
No, it's just what you talk eccentric. About.
Just talks I like really eccentric. Guys. We don't make fun.
I've been here like 8-10 years, so my voice is bad.
It's figuring itself out.
It's almost Canadian.
Oh, there you go.
I feel like American and New Zealand becomes Canadian.
I thought New Zealand was the Canada of that area.
It kind of is. I feel
and
like
Australia is the America.
Yeah, America's America. Australia is definitely the America. Yeah, that's without a doubt.
Yeah,
but we always wanted you to America, to be here, really. Yeah, America.
Thank you.
And you guys are in town filming HELLEVATOR season 2.
Yes, we are. We're really excited for a brand new season.
It's a lot more David Fincher than last season. Oh, okay.
We were joking about you guys coming on, but like, I saw first season, people were losing their mind on this, and then I came in to see the set on Monday, and I was like, oh my god, like, this was all approved, and it's
very mean-spirited.
It's very mean-spirited this season.
There's gonna be so much crying this season.
I always laugh at scared people, and now I do it as a job, so thank you.
How much is it influenced by haunts and things like that, like each scene that they're doing?
I think the first season was more haunts and haunted attractions, and now it's a lot more cinematic in the sense where it really does feel like you're an interactive kind of horror movie hell, you know?
Yeah, you're starring in a horror movie that you don't know the script of.
So did you guys research a lot of the different haunts? And not even like the haunts, the things like the escape rooms, or like we were talking before the show about the one, the McCabe house? Is that what it's called?
Oh, McCabe Manor.
McCabe Manor, yeah. That's it. Where it's like you pay thousands of dollars and they torture you for a night. Exactly. Did you guys research all of these beforehand?
Well, we were in a documentary called Haunters done by John Schitt. I
think all of us.
Yeah. So that was right when after the pilot for HELLEVATOR and right when we were starting season one. And so he was telling me all this stuff. And I know a lot of people who actually work in haunts. So I was getting all the like nitty gritty, but I don't have the balls to do the McCabe Manor, although I got I was offered to go.
Man, I don't need to pee myself.
And have it filmed.
That's an advertisement. Pee yourself.
When I was doing all the haunt reviews for Fango, I kept getting notes that was like, come, go do that, go do that. No. And I was like, that's really not my bag, guys. I just can't do it. I get it if you like that, but that's not my thing.
We need to get some German guy who'd be like, oh, yeah, that would be great.
Well, that's an interesting thing.
Maybe totally into it.
What kind of releases do you guys have people, like how, I know some of these haunts now, or some of these trials, or whatever the hell they even call now, survival rooms, have these, you know, signing waivers of touching and being depreciated in many, many possible ways.
You will be humiliated.
You will be depreciated. I like that on a t-shirt. But what do you guys have to do for your show?
I think
for legal
we're
reasons.
Allowed to depreciate our contestants.
Right.
So
you get to
then
smack
I'm definitely
people.
In.
Oh, yeah. Well, they basically sign their lives away. If you were here, you're saying okay to everything.
Wow.
And there was stuff they didn't see on camera because we have little henchmen that come around. I think the henchmen are going to be more featured this season, but they have these horrible little masks and they wear like a hoodie and they show up and they say things like, shut up, get in the elevator, shut up, don't talk, shut up.
Wow. Yeah.
And this is in between. And then people are like, why were they crying? I'm like, yeah, man, because there's five guys screaming, shut up. They probably thought they were like in Scared Straight, you know, that prison show where they did
I love that show.
Right?
I don't want to be in that show, but I love that because it's all so formulaic and exactly the same where every show, the 14-year-old girl's going and they're like, this isn't going to do anything for me, y'all. I don't care. This sucks. You're stupid. Everybody's stupid. And then, like, 10 minutes later, they're crying. And I'm like, this is kind of...
Well, it's more like the early era of psychology where they did those kind of experiments on people, like Milgramash, where they say you're giving a guy electric shocks and you really believe it.
Oh, I saw the experimenter recently.
Or Stanford. Yeah, experimenter and Stanford prison experiment.
Oh, yeah,
very
DOS
similar.
Experiment.
But then now we can't. We have too much ethics, you know, in psychology replaced any fun.
Wow.
So now we have game shows. And you guys. And people pissing themselves.
They threaten to piss every episode. And, you know, I won't let you know which ones actually piss themselves.
Have you actually had somebody pee themselves on set?
I don't think so, because he, in the labyrinth, he dove into the pool and he was very like not wanting to get his hands dirty. And I was like, oh, he's a covering a little pee excrement.
That's smart.
Yeah, because I was like, why did he dive into the,
hope you guys drain the pool.
Were there any, if you can even say this, but were there any people that you couldn't feature? Cause it's just like, oh, that person did not react well.
They got
like anything
too
much that happened off camera?
There is I probably even shouldn't say this, but you know, it never aired.
Whatever.
There was this test team, and for some reason, they thought it would be really funny to go on edibles through HELLEVATOR.
Oh my gosh.
And so we thought they were reacting to things with normal, coming in zero fear level. And
But we're from Vancouver. We started picking up that they were baked pretty
it
fast.
Was, there were some moments where they're just walking down the wall, they're hugging, and we're like, no one's there, though. What's
our Vancouver sense was going off, and there's this part where one of them had to put a hazmat suit on and she just started freaking out and they're like, oh no, it's too constricting, don't let
we had to stop, and everybody runs in there, and that's
and we're
when
just
we
like
found
she's baked, she's not suffocating, she just high.
And did that air or not?
That was a test team.
You're sending that to us.
Wow.
I'm so there.
It's somewhere on the raw footage. Oh my god.
I so want to be on the test teams now.
I want you guys to be on the test team. There's no, you know what?
And Turek. Add Turek as well.
Yes.
I love
Ryan Turek.
If anyone's going to piss themselves.
Totally Turek.
That's a challenge, Turek.
He's pretty resilient.
No, I know. He does camp. He does that. He does the camp out and stuff. So he'll probably beast it.
Well, you know what? I wanted to ask, because, you know, we want to go back and talk about the very beginning eventually and kind of talk about your careers, but the trajectory of your careers, you've been going from film to film. How did this show happen? Because it seems like at least the timing of it, like, was this something you were even looking to do? Like, the HELLEVATOR, you know, show?
No. No, I remember when the press release came out before they had hosts, and Jen was so pissed off. She's like, man, I wish I was doing that show.
So I started posting it. I obviously, Blumhouse noticed, because here I am today.
No. But I started, as soon as the press release went out, I put it on Facebook. I was like, oh, wow, that seems like a really good idea. I wonder who's going to host.
And then it was, and then I was just fishing for people to be like, oh, so
the show existed first. I didn't know that.
Because
first I heard about it was you guys, and it felt like your idea.
Thank you.
Came in at the right time. Okay. Now we're synonymous with HELLEVATOR, but no, we tried really, really hard.
I'm bummed I missed when it was Adam Green's HELLEVATOR. What a bummer.
Adam Green and Joe Lynch.
Joe Lynch's HELLEVATOR.
Oh, well.
Stay out of the HELLEVATOR.
Actually, those guys should come on HELLEVATOR.
Oh, they should come on HELLEVATOR.
After us.
After us.
Well, you know, it was January, and I don't know, in the film industry, January, there's like, will I ever work again? Yeah. And our people were like, would you ever consider being in front of the camera? Because you guys are kind of funny. I was like, oh, okay.
Yeah, life kind of dies from November 30th till Sundance.
And I'm glad that you guys
over.
Said that, because, yeah, you see it like every single year where by January, my friends are like, I'm going to have to move back to Idaho.
Yeah,
I don't know what to do. It's all over. I can't pay my mortgage. And then the next month, they're like, I'm editing a Marvel show. It's hell. Or I'm doing something for blank. And it's
by the time summer hits, it's like, I can't stop working. I can't wait till Christmas. Yeah. And then by February, it's like, I guess I could go back to waiting tables.
Yeah, well, remember when Kurt Cobain was on Saturday Night Live, he was living in his van. So, like, you can have success and your life can still be kind of shitty. Yeah.
It's like people who think your life's great from Instagram and they think, oh, wow, that person's doing so good. And you're like, well, I don't post the other photo.
Let me post that photo.
Yeah, like, leave my photo in the toilet. Nobody loves me.
Me not understanding how to do my taxes.
Yeah.
Sitting there in the bathtub with the razor blade, like, do I end it tonight?
So,
my taxes. They were looking for like a scream queen, and then they heard that we existed. They're like, oh, lady directors, that would be interesting. But they didn't want two, and they didn't want Canadian. They're like, oh, we'll talk to them anyway. And then I think we talked for like an hour straight, and they're just
gently
like,
forced our way in.
And
I think when people haven't seen us before, they were like, what is happening? There's just so much to talk about. Oh my.
But if you're looking for a horror show, and I think in the first interview they said you're hired, and then they're like, oh no, we have to. And then
we have to ask 40 other people.
Yeah, we flew into New York. We went into LA. We went everywhere just to make sure that we were the right
fit. You had to trial.
We had to actually. The scariest one is when we were on a live feed in LA with New York and LA both there deciding who was going to be it. And we talked for another 2 hours. And afterwards, they're all like thumbs up. But you know,
did they understand horror? Or like, I mean, if I don't know if it's Jason Blum, but the actual GSN type people who maybe know nothing about genre stuff. How were they kind of judging?
It's definitely a new path for them. Yeah. Well, the thing is, they're trying to get that younger audience too, right? And that show definitely brought it in things like Idiot Test and Skin Wars. But you have to understand, Family Feud people have been watching it since Family Feud started. So they see the new programming and they see the old programming. So our show gets a lot of angry letters, which is kind of cool.
That's free advertising.
But a lot of dads DVRing and writing angry letters and watching it late at night going, oh, yeah. HELLEVATOR, baby.
Oddly, kids love it.
Oh, really?
Oh, I believe it.
Yeah.
I remember, and I don't think it actually happened, but I remember hearing that there was going to be something along these lines, and this is like 10 years ago on MTV. And it never happened. And I was at Fango at the time, and they were like, yeah, they're doing this like tortury kind of. It was when Saw was just starting, like a Saw show on MTV, and it never happened. And I was like, that actually, they kept describing it as like Double Dare, but with torture devices.
Wow.
Like, that's a kind of cool setup. And then you guys kind of created that. So I like it.
Well, so you had cultivated, like, it seems so natural that because you guys know each other so obviously so well, but your personalities doesn't seem to be something you have to put on this kind of, I don't know how much is a character that you have to put on.
We're unfortunately that exhausting in real life.
Right. Well, I think that's probably what, like, kind of sings through to these people, because it'd be very hard to maintain this. You know, if this was just like an angle to play, you'd get exhausted of it, you know?
Well, you should see us with Red Bull. Then it's just all shit hits the fan.
Let's do it.
But I think it's hard when you have a character that's not, because there are people who have like a character in their real life. Like, for example, we worked with a lot of WWE superstars and Glenn Kane Jacobs. He couldn't be farther from a demon from hell. I mean, like, he has his own insurance company, and when he's not wrestling, he's doing Make-A-Wish, he's visiting, he's doing a charity thing. Like,
does he do it as Kane?
No, not as Kane. Not as Kane. But the thing is, they're hardcore Kane fans. But his personality is so different. So yeah. It's so funny. I remember he was like figuring out his he's figuring out his insurance training while he was dressed in his like See No Evil 2 like horror outfit, and he's just like, just studying for the test I have for this insurance company. I'm like, wow, it's just such a juxtaposition. Yeah. But I think that's what kind of why he did corporate Kane, because he wanted something a little bit more who he actually was.
You mean 50 Shades of Kane?
He's so hot. He shows up and he's like, business is on, rips open the shirt.
So no. Glenn's going to listen and be embarrassed and we won't be friends
Glenn,
anymore.
You look amazing. Worth not eating bread.
Did you find that with most of the wrestlers, that they had like this personality on camera and then a completely different off?
Usually it's the opposite. Usually they are their character to an extent, except for Goldust. Definitely, except for Undertaker.
Like the guys who actually, Bray Wyatt is the coolest guy.
Oh, he's
in the
so
world. The Wyatt family. Uh-huh. Yeah, they're
were you guys
awesome.
Young wrestling fans? Because like I mean, 90s. That's when I, yeah,
Attitude
when I was
era.
Was
totally
Brutus the Barber beat
Generation X.
Shawn Michaels.
Yes. Socket.
Yeah. Shawn Michaels is my gateway wrestler.
Yeah,
Undertaker was mine. And actually, See No Evil 2 originally ended with a cameo from the Undertaker.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Oh yeah, and I was like, I don't even care. I want to meet the Undertaker.
Done.
Oh, and God. I get paid to meet the Undertaker.
Like,
cool.
First phone call was two things. Girls you hired. Second thing, the Undertaker's out. We're like, oh,
did the first thing have to do with the second thing? No.
That's yeah, I watched like my entire way through college. We used to play the game all the time too.
Oh,
nice. So, yeah, that was like my college.
Who
like,
did you play as?
I always played as China just because I liked her because she was
May
the
she
best.
R.I.P.
So yeah, she was pretty amazing. But
Jake the Snake
and then
Roberts,
in
man.
The later
Jake
version,
the
I played as Lita pretty regularly.
Lita was crying. I loved her.
But yeah.
Yeah, I don't think
so. That's wrestling.
Well, yeah, I mean, I we'll get back. We'll get to that. We'll come back to the wrestling because I feel like that's a little later. But we like to, well, as Rob said earlier, we like to start at the start. Like,
oh, yeah.
when did you guys get bit by the horror bug and how did it emerge? Was it through seeing old films? And also, you guys are unlike anyone we've talked to before because you guys, I assume, experience, especially when you're young, things at the same time, whether it's exposure to like new movies and horror films.
Oh, yeah.
So how did that all begin with you guys and where are you from in Canada?
We're from North Vancouver, Canada. We share a time zone.
Yeah.
Not everyone in America knows. We're just like straight up. It actually takes 2 hours to 2.5 hours to fly there.
And you play LA in the movies, mostly, more than LA does.
So, not anymore. You know. We lost the tax credits.
That's true.
Thanks, Chrissy Clark. But I blame my mom. My mom is a horror girl, and she loved Stephen King and Anne Rice, and she had all of the novels, and she tricked us into reading at a young age. She said, if you read the books, you can watch the movies. And I got so addicted to the books. I think I watched one movie later and said, oh, it's shittier than the book.
It's Pet Cemetery. You were disappointed.
Yeah. But our first one was Poltergeist.
Mary Lambert.
Mary Lambert. Yeah.
Sacrilege.
Wow, you're legit. Yeah. Look at that.
Legit.
Fake geek
we
guy.
Fake geek guy.
I got destroyed.
There's like six women in horror films.
And I named one of the two Marys.
Years ago. We know them all.
Mary.
I've met her too. That's even sadder.
No, but she was a kid. She didn't understand the book wouldn't be the same. She thought it'd be like a 6 hour, the exact same thing. So it's surprising. I even remember before that, and remember video stores?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And the horror.
We talk about them a lot.
Yeah. Oh, there is such an important part of all of our childhoods, right?
Yeah.
And we were addicted to the horror section. So even before we were allowed to watch them, we would always be there and we weren't allowed to rent the movie. So we'd look at the pictures and we'd be like, oh, this guy has sharp teeth and this guy has no face. So, Mom, this guy eats faces. Can we watch it? No.
That's how we watched every House movie.
Oh, House is about Ding Dong Your Dad.
Ding Dong is the scariest movie of all time, apparently. do you remember other covers that like totally got to you guys that you were thinking about but maybe couldn't rent?
I remember the Hellraiser one. Was it the hands just holding the box?
It was his face on it too. Because it said down at the bottom. It
and
was
all the
like
kind of bondage symbols.
Yeah.
I don't think that had any influence on you guys, American Mary.
At all. We saw that young.
We saw that when we were 12.
Let me touch you, damn it. I didn't know what was happening. I was like,
And that was, my mom always had a rule that if you were old enough to ask, you were, she was old enough to explain. And then I remember Hellraiser was, you know, skipped that rule. Because I remember, I was like, what was happening? Because weren't they related? She's like, don't worry about that.
Come to daddy. Come to daddy.
I thought that was her uncle.
No, nah. that's a conversation in a few years.
Hey, it's Uncle Frank. It's just Frank.
It's just flowers in the attic here. Just read this book first.
I remember seeing that way too young and like, why is he giving her a bath? I thought they were, yeah, it's weird. But yeah.
So your mom seemed like, you know, the person that you would, you know, would introduce you to these kind of films and stuff like that. Were there any that stuck out? I mean, was horror the thing that you guys kind of, you know, kind of related to the most, or did you just love all movies at that point?
I think all movies, but I think we didn't realize there were horror movies because if people didn't die, we really didn't like the movies. It was a big thing, blood and guts and action.
I don't understand the difference between a horror movie and a regular movie. You know that Bill Murray movie, Scrooged?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That was my Christmas movie all the time.
Oh, yeah. Still, it's ours.
Oh, it's perfect.
It's our family
Christmas movie. Yeah, oh, movie. And I brought it in at grade 2. We were all allowed to bring like our favorite Christmas movie, and they're like, we won't play this. And I was like, well, it's the Scrooge story. And they're like, but it's scary because there's ghosts. I'm like, well, the Scrooge story always has ghosts in it. I don't understand.
The effects were too good.
Who did the effects in Scrooged?
Oh. Ooh. Oh, crap. I know this,
5 seconds, guys. Oh, no. I will solve this for you.
Those were some beautiful effects, like the ghosts of Christmas Future.
The little things throwing berries out of his chest. Or
I can't tell you, great Danny Elfman theme. And that was kind of like, you know, when I was getting into Danny Elfman's music, oh, that's the guy that does all the Tim Burton stuff. And
looking it up.
Great. Did you guys see any films like in a taboo way where you weren't meant to see it? Right. Because that's different from most of us. Well, actually, her mother also let her watch stuff. In our case, we probably were watching somewhat backdoor legally.
We were renting, you know, like I always told the story that I had like a dude with a mohawk that ran the mom and pop shop walking distance and would just let me rent anything.
Really? Regardless of age?
He's like, have fun, dude, you know, whatever.
Yeah.
And it was, you know, the funniest thing ever is like, because my parents are a lot older and they, you know, they're like old school Italian. They're not paying attention to anything I was doing. the funniest thing is like, I'm 25 at this point and I'm watching a Friday the 13th movie and my mom walks into the room during one of the scenes. It's like, they also had Sixth Sense. Like, moms would walk in during a sex scene. Like, what are you watching? And it's oh, God. She came in the middle of Friday the 13th 5, which is mostly all sex anyway, and was like, I don't think you should be watching this kind of stuff. And I'm like, you are way too fucking late. You're about 10 years late.
Yeah, past things. But because that's often like when you're a kid, you see a taboo image and it's what actually kind of infects your brain because you get addicted to that feeling. Yeah. Was there anything like that you saw, or were you guys just totally, it was cool?
Really, what fucked you up? That's what he's asking. It was like, whoa.
What fucked your shit?
Maybe we shouldn't have seen that.
You know, our first one was Poltergeist. And you know, I didn't realize until later there's the scene where the guy rips his face off.
Mm-hmm. Definitely a Toby Hooper scene, I'm sure.
That was like a child moment that I blocked that out. I remember seeing that older and being like, that was, what the hell was that in that movie? I don't remember. And I was like, then I remembered it once I saw it.
Yeah.
Because I always remember what are those repressed memories?
You remembered all the Spielberg stuff, but the Toby Hooper, the really fucked up shit, you're like, Spielberg did not direct that. I'm sorry. He never directed the guy peeling his face off. Never.
I know we weren't allowed to see Bram Stoker's Dracula, we went and saw it. So we ran and snuck it right away. And I remember watching it. I was like, okay, there's some titties.
We weren't allowed to watch because of the titties. Blood.
A little bestiality.
I was like, ooh, because I snuck Hellraiser, and I understood why I snuck Hellraiser.
Acting so hardcore? It scared me.
Hellraiser?
No, Bram Stoker's Dracula. Really? I thought Gary Oldman was going to get me.
Scared you.
We had to
bitch.
You ran with me.
Out of support.
Oh, yeah.
What's that support. Wolf? Werewolf?
Jen was from the hardcore side of the womb, y'all.
Yeah. Who was first? Who was first?
OG. Guess.
Now it's too late.
I was my 19.
I'm going to guess her.
But we were delivered by two different doctors because I almost killed Jen in the womb.
Did Jeremy Irons play both of them?
Oh, I wish.
Because that would be the greatest story ever, and it would totally connect the rest of this interview.
Wow. That was such a good joke. We can put another beer.
Right, yeah, I deserve that.
Let it be like folklore from now on.
From now on,
He did it.
Split screen, Irons did it.
That would be amazing.
That is amazing. Back before when they couldn't actually do some of the effects you can do with two people now.
Yeah.
And being twins, like, did you ever see a film about twins that actually felt like they nailed it? Like,
see, I saw Dead Ringers late, and I came in with like the, oh, it's Jeremy Irons and Jeremy.
It was the Parent Trap, wasn't it?
Yeah. Oh yeah, because I saw that thing.
Yeah, Lindsay Lohan's great in that.
Hayley Mills,
go back.
Oh, there's another one.
But I remember right away watching Dead Ringers, thinking Mr. Cronenberg must know identical twins because there's so much weird shit that twins do. Like, there's
the idiosyncrasies that he got, the weird mannerisms.
The blatant really honesty that twins have with each other, because when one twin wouldn't say what the other, that chick was like in bed, he's like, well, I've already fucked her, so I don't know what you're keeping.
Yeah, Jen always gives me a hard time if I don't tell her about my dates. No, I'm kidding.
No, over coffee, I will give you the total breakdown and then be like, yeah, and I said I had to work early and go.
Yeah, I'm your roommate, I know.
Or any of that when you guys have been apart, I don't know how often you're, how long you're apart, but have you ever
19 minutes sensed, we just said
19 minutes. But have you ever sensed any of the things that twins do talk about, like knowing somebody is emotionally in trouble or
are you psychic or, is what he's asking.
I'm trying
now
to ask, are you psychic?
He's skirting a lot.
Well, what's the longest period you two have been separated?
Oh wow,
probably like 2 weeks.
2 weeks.
2 weeks when my grandparents' apartment building burned down and my mom my grandma moved in with my parents and I came in to help. Yeah. So we were 2 weeks, and what, still had to keep working, and that was while she was writing American Mary, too.
Yeah.
So she would write American Mary and then send it over to me, and then I'd make notes and send it back over to her.
You know, not wanting to be alone with your thoughts is a great motivator, and you write some weird shit.
Yeah.
It's like, you don't even realize you're thinking about it, because you're like, I'm just working, and then you look at back, and you're like, whoa, man, I had a lot of stuff I was working through.
But yeah, when we're apart, we can sense how the other one's feeling. I can get a feeling of dread, and I'll have to call Sylv and something will have happened.
My favorite story is Jen went to a cardio class, and this is back when we were kickboxers. I was like, I'm gonna keep watching Maury, and she's like, I'm gonna go to the gym. I was like,
Sylv is better off. Better plan.
And then I was sitting there and I started sweating and breathing really hard while she had her cardio class. And
was it a good episode?
It was just paternity test. I miss the makeover.
I think Maury's a workout. It is. I think we just proved that you just did like,
what's it gonna be? And then she comes back. I was like, damn it, Jen.
But I think the weirdest thing is we dream the same place that doesn't exist.
Two places.
Wow. Yeah.
The place at the end of the beyond?
Because walking that with the bodies laying there.
I've been waiting to meet you guys my whole life. I want to ask what happens right after that moment. Like, just tell me. So cool. Did I get my geek card back for that or not?
Yeah, all right.
Thank
you.
One is a forest. And one is like a Silent Hill Jacob's Ladder version of our childhood home.
Wow.
Wow.
And I remember we once had the, because the house one was easy enough to figure out, but we were describing one of, because I am such a Freudian, I'll wake up and I'll be like, did you dream about anything last night? Well, that means you have unresolved issues with your father. Yeah. You should call him.
And I'm like, that's cool. That's a dream. So what do you want to have for breakfast?
No. And we were describing this place and we were like down the ridge and the river and the, because I was running from zombies once and she's like down that cliff where the river was. We discovered it was the same place as we started.
And there was like, logs. Wow. Yeah, it was very exact. Huh. It was weird. Yeah, I don't know what that means.
Have you guys ever like investigated other twins or have you been friends with other twins?
Oh, dude, we tracked down other twins. I love other twins because it's like they know the world from a different kind of perspective. Yeah. You know?
Because when you see another pair of twins, you twinterview them. Who's older? Then I'll speak to the younger and she'll speak
to
the elder.
To the elder one.
They got stuff to get off their, chests.
Yeah, yeah. There's the Enton twins. I don't know if you know those guys.
Seconds apart?
Seconds apart. They write, direct. So we met them through a friend, Sean, who works also on HELLEVATOR. And it's because they do the same job and they're twins, it was like the perfect storm. I was like, oh my god, you have the same weird stories. Plus it's your brother. Plus it's your twin. Plus you do the same thing.
Was there another movie, Twin Idaho Falls?
Into them at Blumhouse for the longest time. I thought that it was one guy and he worked multiple jobs in both buildings.
No, you did.
He works nice. With us. And we ran into him and he was on the upper level in our building. And then I like
block all this stuff out.
And he was in the other building.
I got work to do.
And he was in the kitchen and I was like, oh, you just changed your shirt and you were there.
Oh, the two twins. I know what you're talking about. Yeah, okay, all right. No, because the way, when we do report into Blumhouse, there's two buildings.
Yeah.
And there's one guy that works on production, on pre-production in our building, and apparently he has a twin brother that works in the other building.
No.
So for a while, I would always say hi to both. And then I was like, hey, man, how's it going? I thought you were over. And he's like, no, that was my brother. And I was like, what?
Yeah,
it, I felt like such an asshole. Mind. And he's like, no, everyone does, and it's weird because I work at this building, he works at the other. So,
Shut
next time you guys are there, I'll point it out to you. Like, there he's got a different brother.
We're going to go bother those guys.
It's crazy because you'd see one in one building dressed one way having coffee, and then you'd walk over and he'd be at a desk in the different building, and you're like, my whole universe is collapsed because of this, man.
No, it's good. It's good. It's good luck to have at least one twin always around.
You know? There's a super cute documentary on, I think it's on Netflix, called
The one I was saying about the cream?
Twinsters?
But is that good?
It's really interesting. As a layman, I thought it was fascinating. I don't usually watch things like that, but it totally.
I know, and
me.
That's it. I love documentaries, and I just like, oh, let me give it a whirl.
I think you
and
guys would appreciate it because
they like it's. And she's actually an actress. The main one who made the doc is an LA actress, a little tiny Korean girl, and she. I guess she was sort of sensitive, but she didn't know she had a twin.
She was adopted to an American family.
So it's about her finding out that in Korea. She actually has a twin sister. And
she's in a clip on YouTube, and the guy from Paris, France, sees her, and thinks to himself, you look just like my friend in France, and contacts her and says, you look exactly like my friend who's like an art student.
Like through Facebook.
A fashion designer. Wow. And then the girl looks at her and goes, oh my God, that is me.
Oh,
and they're 20 and
like,
$2
They're like, wait a minute, I think this is my sister.
And they spend like a whole year or so just talking on Skype, and they're still not sure if they're related.
Wow.
They can kind of tell they're related, and it's kind of obvious. And then they go back and trace the records of Korea, and you go all the way back to South Korea. And I just thought it was super
really
cute.
It's really sweet. It's a really sweet
document. But it makes you also realize there is something. There are so many similarities in the way they laughed, just like you guys were laughing, that was where it connected. They're different personalities, definitely different people, but man, when they
laughed,
when
their adoptive parents met the other one, that is like the sweetest thing ever. They walk in and like, oh my God.
It's,
you know, because they obviously raised this one sister, and you know, and they just can tell. Right away.
And then the one really stabs the other, and that's why it's a horror film. It's a horror podcast.
It's not at all. Sorry.
Spoiler alert.
Sorry.
Is director attached yet?
It's all yours, girl.
I'll do it.
Take it to town.
So, let's go back to the beginning. So, obviously, you guys got into horror movies. Your mom was very supportive of reading and getting into this kind of material. But how early on was the idea of filmmaking? I mean, were you always kind of doing creative stuff in general?
Well, we were very artistic, but the kind of shitty thing is young girls don't get encouraged to be directors, writers, or producers at all. Right now, if you're a young girl aspiring to work in film, great time, because there's so many girls that are behind the camera as well as in front of the camera. Mm-hmm. And I always love storytelling, both of us, and we love video games and comic books and movies and TV. But to be part of it, I was told, oh, you have to be an actress, and to be an actress, you have to play twin roles.
And also, twins were popular at the time, so they didn't even care. They're like, oh, you guys are twins, so you're going to be actresses, which was cool. But I thought that was the only way I could work on movies. But I remember watching Robert Rodriguez movies over and over and over and over and over again, and I didn't realize I wanted to be Elle, but I didn't realize I wanted to make that story until much, much later. And we kind of walked ass backwards into it. We were at this horrible film school that ripped us off so much money, and then thank God Grindhouse was in the theaters at the time, and Jen saw Dead Hobo with a Shotgun, and she goes, Dead Hooker in a Trunk. I'm like, what's that? And she's like, let's make a fuck you faux trailer. And the school had a list of everything that's too inappropriate, but we put, you know, bestiality and necrophilia on just to make sure they would hate it.
Just to get everything.
Then we played that, and then we turned it into a feature, and it was like we had all these weird skills that never made sense. Like, it's just the weirdest thing. Like, it was almost like coming home.
Felt like coming home. Like, all these things. Like, we worked in just promotions for twins, so we're good at the talking. Really good.
Yeah, we used to be professional.
There you go.
Car companies would hire us, just, you know, because you probably imagine identical twins smiling next to a car, and then dudes line up, and they're like,
we're also very artistic. Our dad's a painter, so we were always drawing. We were never allowed to, like, trace. He'd take it and rip it up if it was traced.
Oh, yeah, no, he was
serious. That was hardcore. It's like, even your shitty drawing is better than something traced. Cool. So.
Yeah, if you do something shitty in my house, my dad would come back with a how-to draw book, and he'd be like, did you maybe need
no, but that's what
did
I
your dad
draw
come
people.
Up with the boycott horror movie remakes t-shirt that you're wearing? Because I'm assuming that's not your father. He's like, fuck remakes.
You know, normally I hate remakes because it's so senseless a lot of the time. It's like you're taking something you love and not necessarily anyone who loved the original is doing it. So
I'll be real, most are shitty. Like, most are shitty. There's way more shitty remakes than great remakes.
Well, what about The Fog?
Get out!
Sorry.
Elric, Matt Curry Holmes
I know.
Is
our,
in it.
Yeah, our Canadian friend does appear in that and die.
Matt Curry spoiler. Holmes is awesome.
He is awesome, and I want to see his new movie. Has anyone seen it yet?
He plays the dad.
I've seen the rough
fog.
Cut. I haven't seen the finished film.
The remake.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
But we'll get to remakes. We'll hold the phone on that. But I like the connection to your dad, though. That's fun. Well, with that film, you also end up casting Elle.
Yeah,
in your movie, which is kind of amazing.
Yeah, Carlos Gallardo actually heard what we were doing, and we're like, we read Rebel Without a Crew, and we're like, we're going to make a movie, but we literally had no idea what went into making a movie.
Yeah.
So we were running from cops with our cameras, which you can do in Canada. We dug in a national forest, but the rangers let people walk around us. And
that's
then
cool.
Helps when you got a tank top and a push-up bra.
Yeah.
Anytime there was a problem, it was like, still
Jen,
take your coat off,
they would
still
just
take
send
your coat
me
off.
Over. I'm like, I'm a film school, dude. And they're like, really? Cool. Well,
the best excuse in the world is David, our teacher from film school, said it was okay.
Yeah, we were more specific. We said Cap College.
Cap College.
You guys
well, you
shot in national forest? Do you know what that would get you here? Oh, my God. Like, if you try to shoot in a national area here in LA, they will have people all over you.
I tried to shoot in Santa Monica once. I had four guys chase me off the beach.
You got a permit?
You have to drive a good 45 minutes out of LA in any direction.
Yeah, the first thing I shot here, we shot in Runyon Canyon, and I had permits, but I was shocked by how, like, and it interrupted production. Like, every 5 minutes, people would come over and be like, you got a permit right here. You got a permit right here.
Wow.
You guys talk to each other because we're shooting here.
It's
but
why nobody shoots
I
here.
I was shocked.
Yeah, true.
That is crazy.
That happened to me when I was just doing an interview in like a park. Like,
really?
I was doing a very casual for a documentary thing and somebody like stopped me and I was like, dude, I'm just talking. I was like, just pretend I'm talking to a friend in the park, which is what I'm doing.
Oh,
we'll be out of here in 5 minutes.
Heartless. Guerrilla filmmaking is alive and well in Canada. Alive and well. Thank
well, who
you,
were a lot of the people in your career? I mean, were people that you met at film school or like friends and stuff like that? So how did you get this first movie together?
Well, oh, wait, let me finish with Carlos.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, Carlos, he said he would do it, but we had to promise not to pay him. And that was the end of the story.
Oh,
we drove
wow.
to LA.
Sweet.
Wow.
Yeah, because he said that that's the spirit of El Mariachi.
Oh.
He's so sweet. He's been so supportive.
Yeah, but we found people from the film school, other stunt guys, people that are just available.
There's
really
also the writer's strike down in L.A., so if there's no work in L.A., there's no work in Vancouver.
Right.
Yeah. So a lot of people were like, let's do something rather than nothing.
Yeah. And then we had, like, guest stunt coordinators come on, too, like Laura Chartrand, who was the teacher at that shitty school we went to. They outsourced a program. He had nothing to do with
that
it.
That program was great.
But he did he did this 37-beat dead hooker fight, the fight where she gets beaten to death, and it was amazing. It was like, and he, I remember as soon as we came in, we were like, can you set us on fire? And he just stared at us like, what the fuck are these two girls going to be about?
Just say yes.
And then I remember we did a full body burn on Dead Hooker, and he just looks at us like, you guys just came in to decide. It was like Elle Woods. It's like, did she wake up one day and just say, I'm going to be a lawyer? I was like, one day I'm just going to make cool movies, and I just did it.
As soon as I knew I could be a horror director, I was like, yep, that's what I want to do.
Yeah, but we had so many, like,
doing Dead Hooker made me realize that acting, I always will love acting, and it's a great way as a director to be able to communicate with actors, but I love storytelling, and I love being in control of the material we're doing. And writing the roles, especially for actresses, because I chased so many roles that I didn't want to do.
Mm. Yeah, no, there's a lot of opportunities that you don't get out there, and it's kind of cool. Like, we have this story where the cast is all 65-plus women, and we keep pitching it, and people are like, okay, so where's the young, sexy friend? I'm like, no, man, this is about these badass chicks that come out of prison, and they're like, yeah, but where's the set? I'm like, one can have a kid, but it's going to be estranged, and you ain't seen any more. Because there's all these really talented actresses that are...
Sybil Danning.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Baby, baby. That's
Could you imagine,
and
like...
these A-list women that have no roles written for them, let alone
badass
roles. But could you imagine, like, a whole group? Because, like...
any excuse to work with Sigourney Weaver.
Oh, dude!
Any excuse. Sigourney, I know you're listening. I love you so much.
Yeah, we
she
fan.
Totally
She's
listens
fan.
To our
yeah.
show.
I know
yeah.
she does.
She has a Shockwaves tattoo on her arm, actually. So, we know.
Yes, yeah. queen.
But that's funny. It's like those kind of concepts I tend to find in foreign films. Like, you know, I'm a huge fan of Korean cinema at the moment.
Oh, me too.
And you saying that, just there's a great Korean movie. It never came out here. I have an import of it called, it's got like eight titles, but it's called Twilight Gangsters. And it's about three little old lady that decide they're going to rob a the bank because they can't get money any other way.
That's amazing.
And it's really like a fucking like, it's I need to funny, borrow that. It's action packed, and it's kind of, it's like poignant. It's really good. But I look at it and I'm like, no one would ever make this as an American movie. Like, there's no way where it's three, like, you know, older women.
Oh, no, not it's a impossible. Yeah. Well, that's kind of the reason why we're doing comic books first. So we have the IP and then we show there's an audience and then you do it because it's so hard. Because our scripts are so weird. Even like with any of them, people are like, I like it. Is it, do you have anything normal in you? And I'm like, this was my worst normal.
See, but then comic books, it's like, it's everyone's just trying to buy every comic book property. So
yeah.
It's kind of like so the end is like, well, let's do it as a comic first and sell it to Hollywood. So
well,
smart.
This one's going to be called Old Bags. Yeah, old bag. Well, you know, it's the old tricks, and everybody calls older women old bags.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great. So, okay, so tell us about the challenge from going from Dead Hooker in Your Trunk to American Mary, because Dead Hooker did the festival run and, you know, kind of got a lot of attention. But, like, what's the harsh reality from that? Like, was it difficult to get the next movie going? Because it seems like almost every movie's a fight, you know?
Yeah.
So what did you learn after the first movie to get to the second movie?
Oh, my gosh. I feel I learned what happened and how you physically made a movie. I did not learn anything of the business side. It was such a, to a certain degree, it was a shit show. Because after we wrapped, it was just Jennifer and me and my ex-boyfriend for a while. And that was just the three of us putting everything together until the movie was out. And then American Mary, nobody wanted it.
Mm-hmm.
The funny thing is, Robert Rodriguez's Rebel Without a Crew is the book that ended with, don't talk about making movies, go make one, right. And I'll bring the popcorn. And that motivated me to make a movie. Nobody writes books about, or maybe I bet fucking Aaron. Lloyd Kaufman has one. What to do after you make your movie? Because Rebel Without a Crew led me to believe that Bob and Harvey Weinstein would just show up and be like, "Girls, here you go."
I'm still waiting, that's Harvey. What's up?
Give me like.
It's gotta be Lloyd Kaufman. How to sell your damn movie? I bet
how to sell your damn movie. There is one. I bet there is one. Absolutely. How to your damn movie series is fucking brilliant, by Lloyd.
So we pitched American Mary for about 2 years and.
That script was already done by the time you were kind of touring Dead Hooker?
Was not done. I was wondering what I was going to do. And when it was done, we had sent it to everybody who was involved with Grindhouse just to be like, hey, you made this and we made this. Thank you so much. And one of those people was Eli Roth. And Eli in... he says, send me the movie. And then afterwards, when I was griping about not being able to sell it, he was like, you know what? Just focus on your next movie. And he's like, send me a script. And I was like, oh, I had no scripts. I was like, oh, well, I have so many scripts. You should pick which one it is. I have this monster one and this one about this medical student that does body modification. He's like, body modification one. Totally.
Oh, nice.
And so Jen and I told him if there's any mistakes, spelling mistakes, I'd be super embarrassed. So I told Jen after I was done talking to him that we have 2 weeks to write a script about body modification.
Wow. Under pressure.
Yeah.
It was tough after Dead Hooker in a Trunk because it's a grindhouse do-it-yourself film, which was the whole heart of the film itself. And then after people saw that, instead of being like, you made that for $2,500, they said, oh, you can't make a real movie. Spoiler alert, it's not more difficult to make a movie with more money.
Yeah.
No, I wouldn't. I mean,
biggest misnomer in the industry, right?
Oh, when you get into Guardians from the Galaxy, I don't think James was saying, oh, I wish I had $6 million again.
Yeah.
No, nobody would say that. It just gets better. But with, they said that Dead Hooker in a Trunk is all you can do, girls. You're just crass and rude and vulgar, which is true.
We're the stand.
We are those things as well.
Yeah.
But we wanted to do something really, really polished with American Mary, and it was very inspired by, Eastern European and,
Asian cinema. We wanted it to be visually spectacular to look at. And my parents heard me pitch for 2 years, and then I think it was like a late 20s birthday. My dad said they were remortgaging the house and they're going to be the first investors into the
film.
Wow.
Yeah. Talk about pressure. But yeah, it was a great experience. We had next to no money to do it, and everybody who came on really liked the story. I mean, we had a suspension right before, so people were really getting into the kind of body mod community because there's this kind of stigma against it. People don't really know what it is. There's this freak show aspect, and once you realize that everybody's just human, it was a really cool set to be on.
Now, does Catherine Isabel just did she sell her soul to the devil and not age? Because she looks
witchcraft
amazing.
The same as Ginger Snaps
in Hannibal. Yeah,
like I just watched Ginger Snaps. I just revisited Ginger Snaps. I hadn't seen it in years.
Yeah, what'd you guys think of Ginger Snaps as well?
Big fans.
You'd seen it before, obviously.
Casting. Oh, yeah. We were mercilessly teased in high school because we were the weird girls who liked wrestling and video games and horror movies. And they started calling us the Fitzgerald sisters. And I was like, oh, no, what are they calling us? So we rented it and watched it, and I think at the title sequence, we're like, oh, that's so cool.
Nice.
That's
a compliment.
She's so good in that film.
She's wonderful. Both of those girls are.
She's fantastic, but I always watched her career after Ginger Snaps, and I got so frustrated. I was like, she's so good at anything she does, and but she's so beautiful, so a lot of the time people can... They get so distracted with the appearance of a person, they don't realize the talent as well, and I saw that Katie kind of went up against that, so everything in American Mary, I was like, I bet she would fucking slay at this. And the only thing I didn't realize is how funny she was. So when we teamed up again and See No Evil, because everyone was dying laughing. Like, she'd do some murder thing, and at the end of the scene, she'd say something, and everyone would be like,
adorably homicidal.
Adorably homicidal, yeah.
Aw. Cinnamon roll covered in blood.
Now, what about, you know, it's funny because you were both making movies at a time period where the business has changed so much.
Yeah.
You know? So between like Dead Hooker and then American Mary and then beyond that, like, what did you kind of learn and adjust to? Because, you know, a lot of back in the day, you'd be able to pre-sell your movie foreign because, you know, based on the poster and the concept and all that stuff. So how did you kind of adapt to the changes in the business? Because obviously you've, you know, sustained through it.
I'm very lucky that I have good relationships with everyone. And as you know, people, you don't know who's going to be where. And I've always been kind. I've always been nice. My grandfather taught me that if you're kind to people, the whole world opens up to you. Mm. And even people used to say shitty things to me, be like, oh, thank you so much. Just taking it on the chin. And then eventually, you know, you never know. Like, I remember Mike Hewitt, who is now working for Universal, felt bad when he was at the Cannes market wanting to buy Mary, because on his site, they had written a very mean review about Dead Hooker in a Trunk. But the thing, it wasn't even the worst one. So I was like, oh, don't be bad. That you just gave me 2.5 out of 5. That's nothing. I've gotten zero stars. I've gotten zero. Don't even worry. Yeah. And they were like, but I didn't know you could make a movie like this. I'm like, yeah, well, at that point, I didn't know I could either.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
But we surrounded ourselves with an amazing, like Brian Pearson, our DP on American Mary. He did Drive Angry 3D and My Bloody Valentine 3D and Kissed as well. And he has such a cinematic eye. And then Todd Masters, who has been our friend ever since American Mary, like, without his medical horror and his prosthetics, it wouldn't have been the same movie. And his team just, they're always there. Like, we didn't have enough money for the whole team, and they would always be there making sure everything worked out awesome.
What was the influence of, you know, being Canadian? We have to ask about body horror, because it's, you know, body horror, modification, rape, revenge. There's a couple of the because even in Canucksploitation type stuff, there's some of the early rape, revenge, I Spit in Your Grave type movies.
Yeah.
This is a much classier version of that. But with body horror and something like Cronenberg's Shadow over Canadian cinema, I guess, how familiar with his films were you when you, like, set out to make it?
And Jennifer and I have been Cronenberg fans for a very, very long time.
Well before we saw Dead Ringers. That could have been it for us.
I remember...
Do you remember the first one?
The Fly. The Fly. I was a prosthetic, like, whore. I would be like, oh, look at that one. I'm the one that watches Human Centipede. I'm like, is that edge lifting? Are they really...
She's watching a Serbian film, and she's like, that's how the baby would react. No, sure, whatever.
No, I don't think no. I'm terrible. But The Fly, and we've rewatched every Cronenberg film again just because, you know, RABID, we want to put not just one film influence, but every film of his collectively influenced in there. Still fucking grosses me out.
Yeah,
Jeff Goldblum Brundle Fly transformation.
It's great. It was our last show. I think it's his masterpiece by far. I mean, I like a lot of his films, but we were saying, like, just within the first like 30 seconds, you're like, this is a great movie. Like, you could just tell.
Yeah.
There's something about the energy of that movie.
We our last show, which we did last night, here with Mick Garrison, William Malone. We were talking, but they told us that there was a film that was being shopped around at the time afterwards called Flies, and it was going to be she
produced
was going to come back, and it was going to be like Aliens was to Alien. instead, it never got done, I guess, because after Fly 2. But it sounded pretty cool. We all got kind of excited about that.
Flies. That is a damn shame.
But yeah, The Fly is one of the most incredible because also the love story is so strong.
Yeah.
But what of his other stuff did you guys react to? Like Videodrome or what were...
Videodrome is harsh, man. Yeah, could you imagine them remaking it now with... Who's that High School Musical pretty boy?
Zac Efron.
Zac Efron. Could you imagine Efron with like a vagina on his stomach? Oh, yeah. And then Zac Efron is a great actor.
Seth Rogen could direct it.
Well, now you're selling me.
Neighbors 3,
like
baby.
An Apple, like,
like what would be the equivalent now? Like USB ports?
USB ports,
like
definitely.
Yeah.
But he already did that himself a little bit with them.
Extends.
They're plugging directly into there. Yeah.
But on the USB port, there's this thing going on that I've been completely like following where you have dead drops and it's things like. I will create a game and I will say, okay, well, level 3, I'm going to dead drop where I chisel out a chunk of wall on a subway and concrete around it and put my USB port. So you have to go find this USB port and dead drop back in.
Wow, that's so hardcore.
I'm like, why is this not in something? This is it's such a cool thing.
The next thing will be the seashells, the Demolition Man.
Three seashells.
three seashells from Demolition Man. That is the future.
I saw like a chart somewhere online explaining how the three
seashells. Yeah, the third one is just throw all the seashells.
I don't want to know how they went.
It was like
there,
just felt dirty.
There was a lot of scooping involved, and it was not clean looking. And then,
did you meet and like? And we'll get to you know, obviously what you guys are doing now because that's exciting. But before that, did you, were there any interactions with Cronenberg or like in Canada? How is he viewed in Canada? Like because
he's here, our god, he's our king.
He's literally king of Canada.
He is our king.
He's not like Vincenzo Natali or any of the other Canadians.
I love Vincenzo.
But he's a
Vincenzo's a bishop.
He's a bishop.
Oh, Canada. He's a bishop. It's like a chessboard.
Is he
really
like a Salem's Lot bishop, like masturbating? That's what was it?
Rob
Zombie
one,
masturbating in the. but like so in Canada, he is considered like you know the David Lynch or you know.
Oh, absolutely, and he's had such an incredible career. Yeah. I mean, even by his own admission, how he's figuring out his art from film to film. I mean, look at Shivers and then look at Eastern Promises. Mm-hmm. There aren't very many directors that can reinvent themselves so much and stay not only relevant, but on top of their game.
But I think his main theme is always transhumanism. It's always about transformation, whether it's an emotional or a physical transformation. I think it's more emotional in the later ones.
Yeah, History of Violence and Eastern Promises definitely has that because it's people hiding themselves. Behind, they're both, you know, undercover, basically. It's interesting. The last one, not the last one, but the one before that definitely threw me, and I kind of want to rewatch it.
Cosmopolis?
It was so wordy that I wasn't expecting it from him.
Oh, sure.
It kind of threw me, so.
I think you need to read the book. I think that's a book run.
People said they love
it. Yeah.
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 Now, so did you ever get to meet him in that early period, or is it now all happening now?
Sadly, no. We were invited to go meet him during the Canadian premiere of American Mary, but we had to stay for the screening, and I was like, oh, shit, I've seen it.
But we haven't. We met Brandon Cronenberg in the most interesting way.
Coolest, awesomest way.
We were
in a warehouse.
In ABCs of Death 2, for W is for Wish, he was wearing a pink toga and a tiara, and we were wearing latex, and one of us removed his heart and the other one put a gem in it, and we're like, oh, hi Brandon, hi, I'm Jen, I'm Sylvia. Cool. Oh, cool.
Had you seen his film at that point?
I loved Antivero. Yeah, it's awesome. Yeah. So good.
It was at the Cannes. Well, it played in Cannes when American Mary was in the market. So I saw it everywhere, and I saw Cronenberg, and I saw Brandon. I was like, oh, that's exciting. And I've met Caleb before, actually. He is the most confident young man I've ever met. I was at Fantastic Fest with Tristan Risk, and she played Beatrice Johnson, and she's one of the most drop-dead gorgeous women in the world. And this little guy comes over and tries to pick the three of us up. and Jen and I are just watching this guy, like, who the fuck does he think he's? I'm like, he's definitely an actor.
We're all in X-Men dresses before the release of First Class, and we're like, who the fuck is this guy? And I'm like, he must have, like, a huge one.
Oh, I'm so
maybe he does. Maybe he has a
mirror. He's got a huge one.
Ladies, can I get you drink? Yeah, I know, he was cool. And then his dad came, and I think he was chaperoning him at the time. He had a big hat.
So he's the like, youngest son, is he?
Is he?
Oh, I don't know. I was guessing.
I don't know.
I have no idea. Somebody might do it. Nobody knows.
They can't all be wins.
Yeah. I have no idea. So, but now Cronenberg Shadow, now that you guys are announced to direct a remake or a sequel or
reimagining.
We were all confused before the show because it said part two, RABID part two. On
if there's one, I'll do that one too.
That sounds good. Maybe they're just optimistic about how the first one's going to go.
Yeah, I saw that, and Jen wasn't on as a director for a while, so that was some heat in the household.
I was going to do one, and then Sylv was going to do two.
Right.
Yeah, that was a contract negotiation I wasn't aware of.
But did you ever find out Cronenberg liked your film or how he reacted to American Mary?
Oh, I know that he does like American Mary, but cool. I don't know how he feels about remakes. But I think because 10 years into his career, he reimagined The Fly. And before, he wasn't as popular. It kind of really brought him to a mainstream audience.
That's true.
10 years into Jen and my career.
Yeah.
A lot of people don't really know who we are, and this is going to be our first wide theatrical release. So I think this is the first time a lot of people are going to be like, who are these crazy chicks? And they'll look back and they're like, what? They did 4 other movies and 1/26th of a film.
I would also, I would also argue that RABID... I love every Cronenberg film, but I wouldn't say RABID is a precious film like Videodrome or Scanners or Dead Ringers.
Well, they're also his early film. I mean, I love his early films.
Almost too.
But I know what you mean. They're not. They're him learning.
Like they said they're remaking Jacob's Ladder. I'm upset by that because Jacob's Ladder and The Thing are my two go-to practical effects movies.
Right.
Yeah. When I say practical is awesome.
It was the first time that I saw Twitchy. James Ladder, where you're like, oh my god, that guy's moving weird.
Yeah,
it was like
so
the first
cool.
use of the Twitchy.
Yeah. Well, you know, also, you look at the log line on Jacob's Ladder, it doesn't sound anything like the original movie. So you're like, well, why? Why would you call it Jacob's Ladder
if
you're making this movie that is not even remotely like that other great movie? So, I don't know.
That's very precious. When you're doing a remake, you have to know why the original was important or why it mattered to people, and you need to add something else. If you're not adding anything to a remake or a reimagine, what's the point of remaking it?
And he was before, really, like Shivers and RABID from memory, I might be wrong with RABID, but were before AIDS had really, like, burst onto the national scene in America, right? Like
I believe so, yeah.
I think they always talk about when it was on Time magazine is when literally the day Time magazine featured AIDS, like, on the cover, it's when that became the issue. Like, before that, it wasn't spoken about, but it was affecting gay communities, but not the rest of the communities in the same way. And so I remember thinking that it's so weird that his films, even though he's not really making them about that consciously, he's, like, just, like, 2 years or something ahead of
that. The Fly was the one that got most associated with that epidemic. You know, I watched
RABID, but because they're actually
it's more
sex
accurate.
With
it's more
people
accurate
and passing something along and draining. You know, they're all interesting. All three of those movies have that element. It was just interesting.
Well, he's a futurist. There's so many trends that he predicts. And the original RABID, they're joking about getting cosmetic surgery and saying, oh, daddy didn't like the old nose and that sort of thing.
Yeah.
To the point that nowadays, people get big plastic surgery all the time. And in 1977, nobody was getting that much plastic surgery.
Now, how do you go about getting the rights to this one? I mean, what you can tell us, whatever that is about it so far. I'm curious if this is something you guys pursued or if somebody came to you about the project.
It came to us. It was a miracle this December, and we didn't think it could possibly be real. And we got back to them right away, and they're like, thanks for the prompt reply. And
the email was very sweet and very casual. Would you be interested in remaking David Cronenberg's RABID? And the answer had to be yes. And then I was quickly like, are these people web real?
Life thing that's
happening.
That's
not the first RABID that's been dangled in front of me.
Yeah, and then the next morning we had an interview, and we talked a lot about RABID and Cronenberg because they've been trying to do a remake for a long time, but it just doesn't. It's fallen through so many times, I think.
I think he's put a curse on most of them.
Well, it's a difficult thing to do. Like, I heard they wanted to do Shivers without sexuality.
That's tough.
I heard that.
I don't see how you could do it.
What is that? Yeah.
It's the weird incest and weird sexual hookups in Shivers that makes it Shivers.
Well, it's
called Tinder.
Yeah.
We replace the name Shivers with Tinder, and that's what you get.
Without
just a big
that,
orgy it's, everywhere.
It's just weird shit in apartment building.
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
Poltergeist 3.
I'd watch
not that either.
I'd watch that. Poltergeist 3. I like it. So, like, they came to you with the rights. They had it. They had funding in place, or they still had to...
Funding in place. It was the first time being a niche filmmaker worked, because we do female-centric body horror.
Right.
So, they were looking for female-centric body horror, and then people have called
us... Canadian.
Cronenbergian before, and so we ended up on a very short list of... We actually... There's a dude that we beat out. I was very proud of it because he had a good chance.
Sorry, Brandon. No, just kidding. Just kidding.
That's cool because Adam Wingard gets all the roles. So I'm glad Wingard finally lost to somebody. About
it. He's up doing Death Note and
I could kill him he's if he wasn't so right wonderful. Now.
Yeah, he's directing. We like love five you, Adam. Tomorrow.
Yeah, but the guest was so fucking.
Oh yeah,
serious. We love, yeah. Like give them all to him.
Yeah. Did you see his new show? Outcast. Awesome. And like, even one episode, I was like, oh man.
Oh, Robert Kirkman is so talented.
Yeah, it was really cool. So how much creative control did you, like, was it just we have a title we're remaking, or did they have a script in place? But, like, how much creative control
you guys
have
gone to
bring?
The questions I may not be able to necessarily.
How about this? I'll vaguely answer.
Okay, do your vague answer.
Rather than vague, let's talk about that in terms of the last couple of projects, because was See No Evil 2 something that came to you or pursued you, or the same thing with Vendetta? And it's like, when something comes to you, how much do you both get to bring to it? Like, when it's a project that you didn't originate?
Well, we get so involved in anything that we're part of. One of the first conversations we have is how much creative freedom do we have with the script? Yeah. Because realistically, every script is the greatest script when it's written, and then shit just changes.
Yeah.
You bring in an actor, locations change, you think of someone comes up with a great idea, and it just evolves. If I come into something and I can't change the script or have any creative influence on it, Sylvia and I just don't do that. We just can't, because it has to be, when you're the director especially, you need to be able to massage it a little bit.
See No Evil came to us out of the blue, though, and we actually started watching wrestling when Kane was introduced, and they're like, hey guys, you have to read this script. You read it right away. It's an emergency. See No Evil 2. I'm like, oh, okay. And then I didn't read it. And did you read that script yet? And I'm like, oh, for real? Because usually that's a week or two for me. Okay, I'll read it. And then I read it. I was like, there's no way this is the same thing, because I saw See No Evil 1 in the theater. And then when the Undertaker shows up, Jen and I have wheelie chairs, and we both push back. We're like, oh!
That's right. In the original, the Undertaker showed up, and I said, hell about getting, you know, working. I just want to be friends with Kane and Undertaker.
But Nathan Brooks and Bobby Lee Darby had a great jumping off point with the script, but luckily they let us be, like, really creatively involved. Like that scene where that was originally a dude that Catherine Isabel played. We turned it into this, like, kind of killery sexed up girl. She's the jock, actually, and she pressures her boyfriend into sex, and it was originally a blowjob. I was like, you know, and this is one of the proudest moments of my career. I always say that I don't get away with half the shit I try and pull, but this was good. When they're like, you can't have him go down on her. I'm like, it's really sexy. Ask anybody. And they're like, well, I don't want to talk about the sex. And then so he's going down on Catherine Isabel while Kane is there and she's watching his dead body. And I was like, yeah, I got away with that. That was pretty cool.
Guy probably didn't write that scene. Yeah.
I also just love that your mother's listening right now.
Of course she is.
So she's somewhere going,
my mom's unfortunately heard this story a lot.
Your mother's lovely. She likes all my Facebook posts. I adore her.
That's really funny.
We're good people. If my mom likes your stuff, you're good.
So quit trying to distract my question. But you can tell me if you can't say that. But do you have some creative freedoms that you bring? You don't have to tell us what they are.
You know, I think people who have missed our unique voice with the last few projects are going to be very happy with the amount of creative control Jennifer and I have in there.
Yeah, if you liked American Mary and you like David Cronenberg, a treat for you.
Besides that, it's still early stages. Like, this isn't cast. In terms of what we should know.
Depends on me checking my phone. We are pursuing actors currently.
Mm-hmm. We have a wonderful actor who has a script right now, and I'm hoping it works out, because we were going to do a movie before and it didn't work out, and I was like, oh, he's so cool. So he might be doing that. But
it's such a good role for our lead, too.
I'm smiling because you know, I love body horror, but when you do a movie with medical body modification, you have a reality you have to exist in. Mm-hmm. But when it's sci-fi and you have guys that do really good body medical horror, and you can do stuff that is just human but not human. Like, I used to play this game Parasite Eve all the time, and I loved
great
that.
Game.
Oh, right?
Great game.
Oh, and when you saw their bodies change, you're like, that's scarier. Because, and that kind of thing for this, of course, but real honest to goodness rabid, like rabies kind of behavior, because people, when they have rabies, they just go insane. And it's interesting to see. It's scary.
So
yeah.
So you cast the youngest Cronenberg son in your new film because he had a big one.
And gave him rabies.
We'll take all the jokes that didn't work and lump them together.
Oh, human centipede them together until they work.
David Cronenberg is a great actor. It would be amazing. Oh my God. There is actually
favorite
something
Cronenberg
in there.
Role. Do you have a favorite? Favorite Cronenberg, him acting.
Nightbreed's pretty great.
Nightbreed's top notch.
I do love him. Jason X is pretty ridiculous.
What's the one with Sandra Oh in it? The End of the World.
Oh, I love that film. That's a Canadian film by...
Yeah.
It's that short comedian with the from that road movie, Road 66, or Route 66.
Yeah. But what's it called? Oh, my gosh.
And he directed it. Don McKellar directed it. Oh, my. Last Night.
Last night.
No, I'm not touching my phone.
It's fantastic.
Yeah, everyone in that movie. That's actually one of my favorite Canadian movies.
Oh, really?
So it's just a good movie. Like, it's just interesting.
It's a great movie. Not enough people know about it
Canadian. And it came out right in 2000. Like, it was about 99 to the millennium change over, and Don McKellar is a funny guy, interesting actor. But Cronenberg plays a very kind of normal guy, and it's like him and Sandra Oh have planned to commit suicide together on that night as lovers and partners, and then I can't remember what gets in the way, but it's all the little things that screw up your final day on Earth. It's cool.
Is it? No, he's the one reading the book, isn't he?
I don't know.
He's working at the company. He's calling all of the customers.
He is, but I think they're still meant to meet.
Yeah, you're right.
And she's gonna do it, and he doesn't show up or something. Cool movie, though. Yeah, weird sci-fi dystopia,
We wrote a part for him in RABID.
Okay.
So, oh, no, you said you wrote a part. I mean, I asked the writer to write it in.
Segue.
We can always delete it. If you need us to delete it.
Segue out.
No, I'll leave it in.
But it'd be cool I hope he shows up.
We hope he gets in there.
We got the tip, and let's shove the rest in.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's fun for us. So we've seen you on the convention circuit before, and you've done a lot, and you guys go above and beyond when it comes to the people that come to your table. Just like so appreciative, and you spend a lot of time with each and every person.
I love those people.
Speaking of, shout out to Amanda Oakes. Who we know is listening.
She was a dedicated last weekend.
I know she was my watching mate, my movie mate. Hey, awesome. Amanda. Hey, Tara.
We bought her a drink.
Hey, guys.
See you already. And they've been super always dedicated fans to listeners. We try not to call them fans either because they're our audience,
they're our friends.
Yes. Super cool. Jonathan Hughes in the UK.
Jonathan rocks.
Soska Soldier. Hi, Jonathan.
I know. I always see them posting about you guys as well, so it's always really cool that the streams are finally crossing here.
Right.
But I think cultivating an audience, which I think is important. I think, and that's what I knew about your first film. I think I might have seen you on a circuit before seeing the first film, but I could tell that what you guys understood that the new world of how these things work is you have to kind of work it. You have to cultivate it, and it has to be genuine. They'll see through it if it wasn't.
Oh, yeah. I think that's what's keeping us employed so long. I think we're very genuine. I don't like calling them fans either because I'm a fan. I'm a horror movie fan, and I'm a fan that's making movie for other fans. Mm-hmm. So that's really awesome. And I think branding is also something really, really important about surviving in this industry. Even if you don't have a thing, like Kevin Smith, he's the I don't have a thing. That's his thing.
Yeah, that's his thing.
I mean, not everyone, people tell us, oh, it's easy, you're an identical twin. Trust me, it's a double-edged sword. A lot of people close
doors.
Well,
it's hard to get off the niche of this, because the Dear Penthouse thing, they're like, oh my God, they can't. Like, my least favorite comment that I see all the times is the only reason you're directing movies is because you're so pretty. I'm like, what does that mean? Thank you for thinking I'm so pretty. They give me millions of dollars to be in shots.
We're actually, they live under here. I just roll it up in the morning.
This is just Masters of Facts.
I had somebody say that about, that's why I was able to climb up in the ranks at Fango, was just because you were pretty, and that
so
just killed
me.
Because I'd be like, "Thank you, but fuck you."
I mean, you are pretty, very pretty,
and it's a lie because she was sleeping with everyone.
Oh my god!
I can speak from experience. Am I right,
Becca? Listen, let me dispel that because me and Elric are not pretty, and we've accomplished a lot.
Hey.
That kills you when you hear that because it's just like, it's how do I even fucking respond to it?
Nobody ever says Eli Roth's successful because he's hot.
He's very attractive.
But nobody ever picks
apart
that.
But you know what? I heard that even as long as about Catherine Bigelow, I would even hear comments to this day, like a few years ago, like, oh, she's still really hot for her age. and things like that. About did after you say that she about won Coppola? The Oscar, but she'd won the Oscar for directing.
Yeah.
And it's still a factor. And as a guy, I guess I kind of get the edge of that, the negative, like how we, because we can't not look at a woman and make think that. But the fact that that would be the first part of that comment,
yeah,
not the part where you go, she made Point Break, yo. You know what I mean? She made Point Near Break Dark.
Was sick,
I mean, these
man.
Are movies like,
my
you know,
favorite movie of all time.
Near Dark.
Point
Break.
I can see why. Point Break. I can yeah. see why.
They've mocked me for it before.
No.
Point Break.
No, they've never mocked you for Point Break.
Right, no, I think we mocked you for Point Break Live. We've never done that.
Oh,
we should go. I want to go to Point Break Live.
Me too.
Because they pick a new person.
I would go any second. I have not been.
We were planning to go to Girls Night Out. There's one in the
we did our non-horror
let's
show.
Let's do it after we're all on HELLEVATOR. Just hang out.
No, definitely. My genre of choice when I'm not watching horror is like it's action. I want things exploding. I want guys with muscles and guns and girls with muscles
Stone
and guns.
Cold.
Yes.
Stone Cold. Oh, fucking yes, Stone Cold.
Sure.
When we had Lance Henriksen on the show, I brought it hadn't
your
come out
VHS.
On, I brought my VHS of Stone Cold for him to sign because I was like, I don't. I love you and everything else you've done, but this is where my heart is.
By the way, Becca, I found video that I took on my phone of that. By the way,
oh, that's amazing.
Cool. Of you
I know.
Getting Lance to sign your Stone Cold VHS.
It.
I gotta dig it out.
What's kind of and you know, if you can't talk about it, that's totally fine. But what are the negative? I mean, because this is a very real thing, and it's every year we see these stats. 6% of the industry, a woman working. What are the worst Hollywood or stories you've had in the industry? Obviously, there's been a lot of great things because you guys are actually like knocking down doors as you're doing it. But what are if you won't feel like it, talking about what are some of the negatives of the sexism, the things that obviously some of them will be obvious, but are there things that surprised even you guys that you've
I've
come
never
up
experienced
sexism. Nothing weird.
No. No, everyone's never? Been really respectful to me and my identical twin sister.
Oh, man, I'm going to
I think they're bullshit.
No. You know, there's the basic stuff, honey, sweetie, baby, I couldn't wait to turn 30 because I was always dubbed a 20-something. You're all, honey, you don't know how the
industry works.
You're just
in your 20s.
Yeah, you'll grow out of this phase. You'll learn how the... And then as soon as I was 30, I was like, hey, I'm 30 now. I know shit about shit. I've been through it for a while.
Yeah, but we were always teased, so I have a pretty thick skin about it. It's just when my mom, it was really hard for her because on Dead Hooker, people would say, like, really mean, like, yeah, you fucking whores, I'm going to murder
you. On social media or on
on your trailers or if they can... And it's people that you don't expect, and it's really angry stuff. Like when we did we were in a magazine holding axes in the woods, and somebody found my parents' phone number and threatened them because we were holding the axes incorrectly, and they wanted to issue an apology for like you don't understand.
Well, that's just weird. Yeah,
you don't plan. You don't plan the kind of crazy.
Those Canadian
like,
hunters are serious.
Yeah. Like, hey, you know, the studio system has never been a horrible experience for me because there's rules put there for a certain reason, and the WWE seeked us out. Like they have been changing their brand a lot, and they're like, we don't have any women directors. Will you do this? And they wanted us to change it. They gave us all that opportunity.
And I gotta say, I reviewed Vendetta when it came out.
Bless you!
And I don't know if there's a movie that has more fucking testosterone than the one directed by two girls. Like, seriously. There's more balls in that movie. I was
Point
like, wow.
Break. Yeah.
Thank you so much. And they didn't want to hire us because Michael
Also,
Luizzi
Dean Cain is super underrated.
Badass for us. Vendetta was our Punisher movie. He's Frank Castle versus the Kingpin in jail. And if you
Daredevil season 2.
They do go to jail and he's working out in the gym by himself.
Yeah.
I saw that Daredevil. We're available.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Well, there's plenty of Marvel shows coming on Netflix.
Yeah,
so you never
I would
know.
Say that. But I think it's the intermediate guys you have to be careful of because they're not starting out and they've never made it big.
Yeah.
And there's a reason. Like my parents never made their money back; they got ripped off. We've been in a lawsuit for years trying to figure that out. Like this is a very
because
very...
they bullshit you about the back end, right? Even if
we
had marketing
contract,
expenses.
Even
XYZ.
If there's a contract, and it'll break your heart. Like Making Mary, I don't like to talk about it because it's such a special film for people that. Was the worst experience making it because the guys I signed away my character rights I didn't know anything like that and then
The guy was exactly like the story we were making guy this yeah. movie about. It's like, didn't you watch the movie? Didn't you realize this movie happened? And then if you look at the later things of American Mary, they've taken our name off the poster.
Wow. Oh, really? Really?
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah. But how rewarding will it feel for you guys to make that money back, pay back your parents at some point?
I'm all right. Thank you, Blumhouse. Yeah. I'm on my way. I'm yeah, on my way.
But I know, like,
that's, yeah, but it kills you because it's your mom and your dad. Mm-hmm. And they're
But they believe in you so much. You know what? The best story I might have said on the show, but my all-time favorite Hollywood story is Jenna Rollins being interviewed about John Cassavetes, and she said, you know, they asked her, oh, how'd you make the movies? And she said, well, let me put it this way. We mortgaged our house 5 times to make movies. And then she just pauses and she goes, I still own the house.
Wow.
My all time. And this is a guy who had passed on, and she's like, that's how she viewed it. She's like, look, we took a lot of risks, but I still own it.
That's beautiful.
And it worked out in the long run, you know?
It
and
does. So it does.
They went all in.
Yeah.
And I think that's part of it for all of us.
Yeah.
One of the differences that I've always noticed between guy directors and girl directors, at least I assume that it's kind of a difference, is stalkers.
And
I only know this because we have some of the same stalkers, ladies.
I'm so sorry.
No. I see your
two
names
of them right
up.
Here.
Three more beers and we're good. Same stuff before, and this guy wrote in the same thing. Yeah. And, oh wait, you're in there too. And I've even messaged you guys and been like, hey guys, they're doing this, and
FYI,
I'm in there, and FYI, he's doing this thing again. And I just don't hear that from guy directors.
And
we're like, it's like a group where it's like you guys, and I talk to Jessica Cameron sometimes, and Jen Lynch, and it's
God, they're insane.
I see these like just venomous things, and I never hear that from guy directors.
No,
well, John Gulliger probably has a couple, but he's got curvature, man.
Well, you know, you wouldn't get naked in every movie.
You
wouldn't
get naked in every movie. No, he's in the new one, Tangerine. Do you guys have to like take like actually think about security? Have you ever had anything escalated?
I've blocked so many people.
Me too. I block people. We've had a scary one that knew where we were and had a plan of how they were going to kill it. But you ever read the book God. The Gift of Fear? Uh-huh. Gift of Fear by Gavin DeBecker.
Everyone should read The Gift of Fear.
Everyone, especially you.
Really?
Especially
I'll bring you a copy.
It's Stalker 101, and Gavin DeBecker is the leading risk prevention officer in the world. He takes care of the president, celebrities, athletes, and people down to a domestic level. And basically, this book is always trust your gut, because your gut is telling you something that your stupid human brain's like, this huge guy's not going to rape and murder me. I'm just being, you know, judgmental. No, something in your little brain is saying, get the fuck away.
Flight or flight. Yeah.
And this book, I mean, I've actually even called the agency because I had a pretty bad stalker. Mm. And they got taken away.
Yeah, but you never know where it's going to come from. And it's that book's all about listening to because you sense it before you know what it is. You're like, well, my brain doesn't have a reason that I feel this way, so I don't want to be, you know, paranoid.
It's all about being mean, because I get that at conventions, too, where I'm talking to them, and they're like, oh, I'm this guy. And I'm like, oh, okay, he's kind of creeped me out online, but it's cool. We'll keep talking, because I don't want to be mean.
It's like funny games. Imagine if they just said, no fucking eggs for you, motherfucker, and closed the door.
It's funny, like, for men, in movies they do it, like Fatal Attraction, but it's so less common than what you guys get. And I feel like I would really struggle. Like, if I looked like you guys and I went to a convention and everyone wanted to hug me and be near me, I'd be like, oh, yeah, cool, cool. And I wouldn't be able to see someone coming who was a little off compared to somebody who's just a big fan.
Obviously, know? I mean, I'm not at all.
Oh, you are. You are.
No, I mean, I've experienced – I like to be a very private person. I've experienced it on a very minimal level, and it's really hard. So I could only imagine – being very public and female and, you know, kind of out. It's just, I sympathize because I hate the little experiences I've had with it. I just want everyone to leave me alone and just want to work. I want to concentrate on the work, and that's it. If you dig it, cool.
Did they talk about avoidance? Is it the idea that to avoid that, or is it to confront in terms of not in person, obviously, but to say to the person, hey, this isn't cool.
You know, there's a great story in it that says X amount of people die every day or every year by coconuts falling on their head. And the way that you prevent that from ever happening to you is you don't walk under coconut trees.
Yeah.
There are different things that you can do in life to just pull yourself out. But unfortunately, I go to conventions, I go to film festivals.
Yeah.
If you try not that hard, my life is an open book. It's easy to find people. So, obviously we're kickboxers. I always carry a weapon on me.
But we don't go
have
any
security.
This is unusual. Because we trust you guys, please don't murder me. But usually I'm looking around. Why is this a weird
thing? I'm talking to Sylvia.
Greg, our board
office.
podcast.
Anyways, but we
doors open.
No, but we usually bring someone with us just in case, because I remember there's this guy on my crew once, and he sent me, he was German, and I have a German family, and he sent me this weird message one night, and I was like, oh, I don't know how he got my email. Weird German message. I'll just ignore it. And then he wrote me a 7-paragraph graphic rape email explaining how he was going to... And I remember sending it to my agency, and they're like, this is the worst thing we've ever seen. And then I sent it to a few people being like, this is so scary. Is this normal? Is this normal? Is this normal? And I remember I sent it to Eli Roth. He's like, I get those ones too. And I was like, oh!
Oh, my God.
And he's like, the way we have to look at it is we're inspiring these people. And he's like, it's different for me because when they meet me at a convention, like, Eli's 6 foot and he's all muscle. People, they deflate when they meet him. Especially this little girl, but when
it's a lot easier on, online. But when you're face to face with somebody,
with a bear Jew, what are you gonna do?
Except in person with us, some people I see get really, because they think this is my one chance of meeting these twins, having this experience, and I think our movies mean something to people, and it's a great thing. But sometimes they see us online and they piece together who they think we are and what they think our relationships are with, and. It's scary. Like, it's the people who you don't see it coming from, I think, are worse than the people that just write, oh, fuck those bitches. It's like, of course those guys hate me.
Definitely. But. I mean, even Spielberg had that major stalker. The guy was writing him emails. They found him on his property. And he had written letters about how he was going to rape Spielberg.
Jeez, I remember that.
And it was intense. Yeah. And so you realize it's not just, I mean, it's definitely skewed. That happens a lot less. But you realize it's a thing about ownership. Like, I like this thing so much, I must possess it.
Exactly.
And that's way to have it. Mm-hmm. You know?
And if they can't do it in a positive way, they want to do it in a negative. I mean, what happened in Orlando, that poor 22-year-old singer.
Unbelievable.
Oh, yeah.
For that's no reason. Insane. For no fucking reason at all.
Happened in Orlando as well? In the same week?
Same day.
48 hours.
Oh, my God. Yeah. I didn't even know that was out of the country.
I was in Australia.
Yeah. I think it's good to talk about, though, because you're not alone, too. There's a lot of people who are on convention circuits, and you're very public. I mean, somebody can go right up to you, but it's also important for those people to understand that there's a boundary, even if they don't see the boundaries, right?
But even saying that, like, us and Doug Jones, we hug everybody.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We love hugging. There's a good energy from that. Yeah. And, you know, most of the people I meet are the greatest people in the world.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, our fans are usually pretty sweet. Awesome.
No, absolutely. 99% of the people who I speak with on Facebook, on Twitter, at the conventions.
Yeah, they're all great, for the most part.
It's a romantic comedy fan who's going to kill you. It ain't the horror guy.
I don't trust them.
But there are a few that are attracted to horror for the wrong reasons. You can tell there's a psychosis there, and they don't they don't understand the pretend, I think.
Yeah, and there's mental illness, but that's not an excuse.
Yeah, and that's not limited to the horror.
Right, it goes to guns and everything. It's not the thing itself. Yeah. It's the people who are attracted.
Exactly. We're getting dark and deep
right now. It's a horror podcast.
Where I was going with the whole convention thing is because in our first episode, we had talked about the first times we had met our heroes and celebrities at these shows and conventions, our stories, and like what was the most embarrassing thing you did for somebody that you grew up admiring. So being that you go to the conventions a lot, tell us some fun stories about some of the people, some of your heroes, some of the people that you grew up watching, getting to meet them. And sometimes I'm sure they come back to you like, we love your movie. And you're like, oh my God. You know, so who are some of those horror celebrities that you've
like Ricky Bates.
Like Ricky Bates.
People you idolize.
Rob and I wouldn't be best friends if it wasn't for Ricky Bates. I don't know why I thought you. Ricky. I don't know why.
You know, that was a hilarious
episode. I don't know why.
You weren't there for that.
I wasn't.
It was at a killer PV when Ricky's like, yo, level with me. Did you send them like dick pics or something? I no. He's like, I just want to know all the details.
Yeah, no, it's weird. I don't know what it is.
It could have been through association. Because if I block someone, I'm like the kingpin. I block your whole family.
Yeah.
Sorry. No, clearly it wasn't you. We're besties now.
We are now.
Ricky Bates is fucking awesome. I remember I was told about Ricky from Anchor Bay because when he did Excision,
great movie,
he was bringing some merch that he made himself, which was a bunch of tampons that he had dunked in red.
Ricky
had gone through the Canadian border with that, and he thought, oh, should have done it afterwards. And that was the first time I ever. And then they went, you'll love him, and I was like, okay, cool. I bet I will. And then when we were in LA, we met in Culver City. And when you're a foreigner, it's really nice when people are nice. And Ricky and I have very similar sensibilities. And we're like, Excision and Mary came out at the same year.
Yeah,
I was like, what?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
You guys have cameos in the
Suburban Gothic.
That's right.
Yeah. Oh, I got to be in a movie with Jeffrey Combs. Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
He doesn't know we're gonna get married one day. It's okay. It's not weird.
Elric sort of knows him. Let him know.
Oh yeah, yeah, yeah.
Tell him.
He's a super nice guy. Like really, of all the celebrities I've met in LA, he was the guy who most surprised me because I actually hear from a lot of people that are, oh, he's a bit of an asshole. And I think it's just that the industry is hard for actors. Like being a director,
it's a hard gig. But
being an actor, I think, and especially in the transition where they used to get paid to do lots of TV, and now I think a lot of these guys are at a point where people like us would want to cast them for like nothing, and they get a lot of those offers. And I think at a certain point, he was like, I remember him talking about not doing Your Next. He was meant to be the dad in Your Next. They offered,
really?
And he's just like, they just couldn't fucking pay. That's all he said. He said they couldn't fucking pay it. And to him, he doesn't know it's going to be great. Like, he has no idea.
Of course not.
And some people want to cultivate that, but some people are just like working actors and they got to go from one gig. So he's always been super, super kind.
Like, we interviewed him and then the next day he emailed us and was like, I want to invite all of you to Poe.
Yeah, he did. And my mom came from New Zealand. My all-time favorite story. My mom comes from New Zealand, and I said, I want to take you to Nevermore, and I bought my ticket online, so he didn't even know I bought it. Like, there's no way he should have known. I bought it independently, took my mother to go see it, and I show up to the thing, and they go, oh, Mr. King, Jeffrey has saved you a seat in the front row. So we got the best seats in the house.
Yes,
so he must have scanned the list. And that's a guy. That's a guy who like has it, you know.
It was great because we showed up as well knowing that there were tickets waiting for us, and it was just like, Miss McKendry, right this way. And I was, no one ever calls me Miss McKendry.
Yeah, he's a cool dude.
I thought you guys were going to like put me in a cardboard box in the concession stand. This is awesome.
So I'm going to wait till the timing's right and things are rocky with the wife, and I'm going to get you in there.
He's your in.
It's not creepy at all that I actually have
his daughter's acting, and she's doing really well, apparently, in New York. I keep seeing posts about her being on stage.
Nice,
you know, that's the way. Cast her in RABID. You're way laughing. Where did that even come from? I don't even remember.
That came from interesting people you've met.
Oh, that's right.
Okay. We've had plenty of fun. I've been going to conventions since I was like 15 years old. And it's like,
lucky.
You remember meeting some of these people the first time.
So. Oh, yeah. Clive Barker was so sweet. And he spoke to us for half an hour just as we were starting American Mary. Ended up giving us a quote for he was so nice. We left and I turned away and we just both cried because I was like, I worked so hard. To get there.
Where was that?
Dark Delicacies.
Oh,
wow.
Yeah. Places, amazing.
One of our favorite places.
Oh, and he spent so much time with everyone. You could tell he wasn't feeling well, but still, everyone got the time. And what they brought to him, it would be like sculptings of Pinhead, and he'd take the time with everybody.
He's super classy. One of my most favorite people that I ever met was Mary Harron.
Wait, maybe I preempted.
You inceptioned that. Yeah, I was like, you know what? I'm going to talk about Mary. No,
eventually,
he's your third twinster.
Yeah.
He knew it.
I'm the butch one.
we're at the same agency, and we were going to do XX together, and then for whatever reasons, neither of us ended up doing it. But when we were in New York doing Blumhouse HELLEVATOR stuff, it was like, can I have lunch with Mary? Because she watched American Mary, and she didn't hate it. I was like, yeah.
One of my favorite moments sitting there, she's like, so girls, what's your favorite horror movie? And we're like, oh, fuck. And then we both go, American Psycho.
Oh, wow.
And she was so genuine, like, oh thank you.
I just became a director because of you. Really? And she's like, I'm going to give you an American Psycho story. I'm like, oh, okay. And I'll say it right now. Okay.
Don't. Just leave them hanging.
And that was the story.
Because
I was so fascinated by how she did it. And she's like, well, it was right before we were doing the threesome scene. And Christian and I were talking. We're like, we should probably plan this out. And we're like, okay. And then, so we rented some porn. And we came back the next day, and we had these little stick people. And here they were. And we're like, okay, we're going to do that one. We're going to do that one. And I was like, you and Kristen Bale did stick people after watching porn together. You guys are so rock stars.
Is she Canadian as well?
She is Canadian.
She's New York based now?
She lives in New York, and I think she goes up to Toronto to film, and I know she's doing the Girls of Manson. Her and Guinevere Turner are
reteaming for that adaptation.
Oh, I love Guinevere Turner. I haven't met her yet, but I'm going to while we're here.
Yeah, I'm very excited. And then I think Mary's working a TV series right now because she just snagged an actress I was after for RABID, but it's okay because she's the master.
She's the master.
It's fine.
Somebody's going to try to decipher that online.
I'd love to know the story about her getting that, because you'd look back at the time and go, yeah, a female director of that kind of book that was so extreme, it seems like a radical choice. And
she
it's
must
kind
have
of,
had a hell of a pitch.
I would love to know how that went
out. David Cronenberg was up for it before.
Oh, really?
Wow.
The one that I heard for a long time, Stuart Gordon doing it with Johnny Depp.
Wow.
He wanted to shoot it in black and white. And
weird.
Really crazy idea. Weird. Yeah, Stewart had it for a long time.
Wow.
American Psycho.
That's interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah, I mean, this is before Pirates of the Caribbean. Like, Johnny was still doing the weirdo movies with, you know, freaking
Jarmusch
and
whatever. Yeah,
yeah. So he was like, yep, I'm in. That sounds cool.
I haven't heard that. Actually, that might be a good article for you guys to
try.
Rob, can we get that one for this?
Well, yeah, I've been meaning to do the Stewart Gordon one for a long time. Because there's bits and pieces of it. But he had it for a long time with Johnny attached.
That's interesting. That's kind of like Preacher. It went through a bunch of people before it landed where it did. And I think, who was the director? Sam Mendes?
Mendes for a long time had it. He had the rights. He was developing the whole world of it. I was so excited to see what he would do. Not that he's particularly edgy, but I knew it would be good. Big.
Oh, sure.
Because he did all the last two Bonds, and then it went to the weirdest place that you could have ever met.
Wasn't it?
We'll talk about the show afterwards.
Yeah. I've only watched the pilot so far, but it definitely, I was still kind of on the back foot with it. Like, I want to get into it. So we'll see.
We'll talk after.
Yeah.
It's like X-Files, you want to believe.
Oh, yeah. New X-Files, I don't know. Mm-hmm. What about contemporary, like your contemporaries, people making films at the same time? We like just joked about Wingard, obviously.
We met Adam Wingard. Oh, this is so funny. So we were downtown with a girlfriend. And apparently Adam was in town.
And
so,
we didn't know, because we knew he was coming in, but he was there like 2 weeks earlier.
Yeah, and then we're walking down the street, and this guy's the most happiest, warmest smile like this. And Jen and
smile,
I...
smile, and he waves.
And Jen and I are like, I don't want to talk to this guy. And we pretend we're talking. And he's like,
we do the duck out conversation where we're like talking really intensely about something, and there's no break in the conversation.
And
no way in.
And he goes, Jen, Sylvia. And we're like, oh, hey.
And that just makes it worse, because we don't know who this person is.
It's Adam. Uh-huh. Wingard. Oh! Adam! It was so nice.
We instantly dropped it. We did. We did. I was like, I'm sorry. I didn't know.
We thought
you
were a total weirdo.
I know the guy
with the Tumblr account. You can trust my Tumblr.
Yeah. And then he awkwardly explained that's how we react when someone tries to say hello to us.
I didn't know. But yeah, and then we hung out afterwards. I poured a Bellini into my crotch, and then it died.
As you do.
We had a great.
It's a Hungarian custom of saying hello. Welcome, Adam Wingard, to Vancouver.
Have you guys had Wingard on this?
Not yet.
Not yet.
No. But I mean, he's directing 12 movies in a row, so it's like, you know, getting him would be tough.
His voice and the subject matter of what he talks about is so spooky.
Yeah.
It's like he was born to make every scary movie forever. He's just so interesting.
Well, the last time I talked to him was when he was editing Horrible Way to Die. Because A.J. Bowen's in
it. Oh, really?
Yeah, I mean, I met him at a bar locally, and it was like, yeah, I'm editing it. It's coming together pretty good.
It's Alabama, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And before that, he worked with Tiffany Shepis.
Uh-huh.
What was the first movie?
Popsicle.
No, there's one before that.
The one with Bill Moseley.
Yeah. That's the one.
Yeah. I forgot the name.
Six something or whatever. Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, he's been pounding the pavement for a long time.
Well, he was like 20 years old, I think, when that one got made.
Really?
His first one. I think I read the story. It's kind of like you guys. Where he just took any money he had that he would have gone to film school and he put it into a little movie. He put just enough money into it to be able to pay for Bill Moseley and Sakai because he knew it would sell if those two people were in it.
Yeah.
And so he just paid them the $5,000 or $10,000 you needed to be in a day or two of a film. And I remember reading about it early, but that one didn't really get noticed. Sick Man or something? But Popsicle was the one that
I think Synapse put it out on DVD. But yeah, then, you know, going
just
on
unique.
To Popsicle and then Horrible Way to Die, right to...
Not all directors you can see the leap with each film. He's
it's
one of the few
Homesick.
I've seen.
Homesick.
But the leap between even Your Next, which is really good, and then when I saw The Guest, I was like, that was the biggest leap I think I've ever seen.
I love The Guest
so confident.
So
The Guest is one of the best films last year.
Yeah.
Oh, it's incredible.
It's so fun.
Well, we were talking about contemporary. We ask everybody because, I mean, obviously you keep up with a lot of people on the festival circuit, but it's like... We're always excited to find these new movies, these new voices. So who are some of the people or some of the movies that have stood out last couple of years that's like, oh, man, I love
The Guest. I just saw some things on Adam Wingard's
Oh, well, that one I didn't know.
They're looking at his Tumblr. Have you ever seen his Tumblr?
I've never seen his Tumblr.
It's just nude pics the whole time.
He's out of here.
He's obsessed by, like, oh, yeah, that's just...
Oh, nude pics of other people. So I thought it was just of him.
It's really funny.
He's been attached to I Saw the Devil for a long time.
I didn't know. I was, like, whispering it. I was like, is this only on my pro account? But, yeah.
No. I Saw the Devil, which I'm mixed about because I love the original movie.
Yeah, it depends what you do with it. I mean, again, like, already
I Saw the Devil?
No,
him and Simon
Barrett. That was Adam's doing I Saw the Devil.
I thought it was another movie for a minute.
Are you thinking House of the Devil?
I thought House of the Devil.
the Korean one, which is pretty recent.
I love I Saw the Devil.
It's an amazing movie.
Oh, it's a brilliant
I can't say what he said, but I asked him about that, and he said something so goddamn good that you're gonna love it. He's so good though, you guys. Him and Simon Barrett just give him all.
But you know what it is? It's like with people like him. It's like
I lost Death Note. It's all good.
Okay. With people like him, it's like when they make an original movie like The Guest. You're like, I want him to keep making those original movies.
That's true.
You don't know how hard it is to pitch an original film. Bob is easily the best thing we've ever written, bar none. But it deals with some dark subject matter, and I think the most difficult thing about it is it's a horror comedy, and it's as dark as it is funny, and it goes dark places, and it goes really funny places, and I guess Cabin in the Woods and the Evil Dead TV series and God knows what doesn't prove that horror comedy works.
But Roseanne had those different levels, like you'd be laughing your ass off, and then Dan would grab his coat and leave, and you're like, oh, shit's going down. Like, I like things that have those multi-levels.
Well, Cabin in the Woods was a huge fucking success, was it not financially? So hasn't
I know it was. I don't think it was.
It was as horror fans,
we think of it
we
as
love it
a perfect
because, yeah,
movie.
We watch it and we're like, this movie's amazing. Really?
But I don't think it did.
That was one of those movies that got delayed, was going to come out in 3D because they were in a post convention. You know, it was a big Lionsgate affair, and then they just put it out. They're like, fuck the 3D thing. Let's just put it out there. And I don't think it did nearly as well as they were expecting.
I remember Tucker and Dale vs. Evil. I remember watching that guy in a test screen and going, oh, this is going to be a home run. Home run. It's so funny. It's
and
perfect.
And it's still kind of an indie
and
look.
Now
like, you know,
and then it's a movie that never really gets seen.
That's a bummer. Yeah, it is so true, isn't
it? Do you guys feel the pressure to consistently keep working and stay busy? Because I think that was the biggest lesson I took away from the Mark Pavia episode. Yeah. We had him on a couple episodes ago, and he had done Night Flyer, Stephen King adaptation back in '90s.
Yeah,
and it took him 19 years to get to the next movie. Huge, but he never gave up, and he's never. The lesson of that is that he's always persevered, and he's never been bitter about it. Like, he's always been the enthusiastic, happy guy. A lot of big projects in them, you know, like you almost did Texas Chainsaw Massacre at the remake before this one got it. And that was his lesson. He's like, the longer you wait, people look at your filmography and like, why hasn't he worked in 2 years? You know, there's that stigma. Mm. So do you guys feel that at all? Like, do you feel like, you know, we got to do something this year, no matter what?
Well, I think Gary Marshall says always have a lot of eggs in different baskets. Because the film that I do next is never the film that I'm expecting to do. Mm-hmm. And one day I'm going to write a book called All the Amazing Movies I Didn't End Up Making.
Yeah.
Because per every movie I actually make, there's so many cool projects and scripts that just don't happen. And there's no good reason why projects don't just happen. I mean, there's not enough money, or you don't lose something, or a producer runs off with something. And you never really know what actually happens.
We've talked about that on the show before, about how for every movie that you see, there's like 10 that you don't
absolutely
see.
Yeah.
And
will
never see. And ones that actually get made aren't always the best. They're just the ones that there was some type of cosmic kismet for. Like, the financing was there and the sound guy showed up and nothing happened and everything was okay and we didn't have to recast. So, it's kind of bizarre.
And then you got, like, Beverly Hills Chihuahua. Like, there's some movies that are like, why does it exist?
Yeah.
And
why demographic for it?
I know, but there's
why isn't there a sequel?
There is three of them.
I just lost my nerd card again. That's the best nerd card to lose.
I think the best way to keep yourself from getting discouraged, because there is so much rejection in this industry, is read a lot of books of people who've been there, so you can see how normal it is to feel this way. Like, Gary Marshall has these two great books, My Happy Days in Hollywood and Wake Me When It's Funny. Both of those are going to help you so much when you're going through. Because he wanted to be a basketball player. Mm-hmm. He wanted to be a basketball player, and he ended up there.
Yeah,
so, you know, you never know.
Jack Nicholson, too.
Wanted to be a basketball player. Yeah,
I wanted
John
to be
Carpenter
a
probably. You know?
He's wanted to play video games all day.
Just so you know, Elric, there's multiple Beverly Hills Chihuahuas. Not even just one.
Rest assured.
Darkest nights of my life.
Well, I always, you know, the advice I always give is just if you have a passion for something, if you want to tell stories or make music or just be creative, have confidence in yourself that you will be able to always do that.
Yes.
Meaning, you know, like some people fixate on just one idea. You know, and that's the thing is it's so common for that one idea to get set up and you get all pumped about it.
Yeah.
And then for whatever reason that's beyond your control, it falls apart. So it's like, you know what? Trust in yourself that, all right, that's not the right time for that idea. Maybe one day I can, but I got a lot of things I want to do. So just keep doing all of them. Keep putting a lot of eggs in baskets and eventually something is going to come out of all of it.
It's really important because so many filmmakers especially want to have Tarantino's career. If Tarantino was starting right now, he would get lost with all the other crazy shit that's there. And everyone thinks you do all your original films directed, written, and produced by you in the order that you want to do them. Whether Tarantino was able to do that or not, who knows? He says so. I think he did. Good for you, man. You're the one guy who did
it. No one else does that.
But nobody else has. No, come on. The soundtracks of those movies. I just sit there watching a Zack Snyder movie and being like, that's my whole budget.
Just for that one, the White Rabbit.
I thought that last night when we were watching that. And you guys saw it at Etheria, the Genghis Khan Conquest. Which was awesome. So I go home and I'm like, I can't believe that they made this in America, because usually if they make something of that grandiose scope, it's like, oh, this was on a tax credit through Canada or something. $85,000 budget. And I'm watching that and I'm like, that thing was like 7 minutes long. I would have made like four movies. It was beautiful. Absolutely beautiful.
Oh, absolutely. But that's a lot of money for a short.
Yeah.
So true.
Well, the moral, keep plugging away.
Your dreams don't have an expiration date. Everybody feels like, you know, I didn't do it in my 20s and 30s. You know what? That 20s and 30s is where everybody else fucks off and gives up on their dreams. So keep fighting. Keep getting your dreams out there.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I feel I wasted my childhood acting. If somebody said, hey, you can be a director, writer, I would have been like, oh, I like that better. Thank you.
Yeah.
Well, you know, it's funny you mentioned the Tarantino example. It's like the one thing I try to tell people is like, look, you know, just from doing the show and interviewing filmmakers, everyone's got a completely different story. Like, you can't mimic. You can't be like, well, that's it's going to be different no matter what. So just follow your own path and, you know, hopefully you'll be the story.
The only thing they had in common was they didn't stop, right?
Yeah, exactly.
It's a verb. This turned so inspirational, guys. I'm like beaming.
Let's go back to Stalker. So, So let's wrap. We'll wrap with. So RABID is saying for us all to be looking forward to what you guys do with this. And after that, you were just talking about the horror comedy that you want to. So hopefully, if RABID does really great, maybe it gets you guys that little bit more power.
Bob the Monster movie.
And I want to see that.
Comic book world. How's that been treated?
Oh my gosh! Really?
I didn't know about that.
Really good. Jennifer and I, our very first time writing any comics that were published was for Marvel in Secret Wars Journal number five with Night Nurse, and we were really stoked. And that was actually really well.
From Daredevil and everything.
Daredevil was in that too. He's my favorite, so we just shoved him into a panel, and it was awesome. And then Neil deGrasse Tyson jumped out.
He's my future husband, ladies. Yeah. Hands off.
Okay.
I'm taking that one.
you may have him, but you know, when he isn't available, you obviously think the Soska sisters. Clearly. So we're writing Jake Thomas, the editor from the first one. He's such a talented guy, and he's got
great
these
taste
great
in writers. Jake, I love you.
And he was like, hey, would you guys like to write a Guardians of the Galaxy story? And I was like, oh my God.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Yeah, that's cool.
So it's Guardians of Infinity. It's number 8. It's the very last issue. So there's a main story that goes through all of the issues where different time and different universe Guardians are in this kind of kerfuffle together. I don't want to ruin it. And then the other half of the comic book is a one-off. And they get different artists and different writers. And the very last one is Jen and me. And it's, oh God, Juanan Ramirez
is the artist,
and he's amazing. Insanely talented, new guy, but totally check out his stuff. And
the first story we pitched is the one we went with. Just like with Night Nurse, the first story we pitched was the one we all got really excited about. And
I lost my shit when I wrote Star-Lord. I freaked out. It's Star-Lord, Kitty Pride, and Rocket Raccoon. And how can you not lose your shit, right?
It's really good Rocket writing. Because we got spoiled because we got to read all of the Guardians of Infinity story because I wanted to see what the other short stories were like. Not that it's a competition.
But yeah. Marvel like sends you all that stuff, right? Like, we need that for research. So if you can send us all those free comics,
Marvel will send you any Marvel. When you're working for Marvel, I'd be like, oh, I wonder what's happening with Wiccan and Hulkling. They're like, here you go, check it out.
Wow,
secure file. Yeah, you are once you're in the family.
Marvel is amazing. It's as a nerd. Have you guys ever been to that? Have you been to the head office?
When you're no, I would love to so much.
Oh, dude, lads, wait, if you when you do your ghost shit, guys, yeah, let's go to the Marvel office. Yeah. I'll when hit up Jake. I'll be like,
the Warren Museum.
When we win the money from doing Hellevator.
Hey, stay away from my money.
Hey. Yeah. Just try to stop us.
We're coming, ladies. And then we're also working with Daniel Way and Rob Dumo on Kill Crazy Nymphos Attack, which is our first full graphic novel. It's 144 pages or 157, something like that.
Let's just keep writing it until we stop.
Yeah, and it's about this dude called Purvis Gunt, and he's a disgusting human being, and he's obsessed with porn and fucking chicks, but no one will fuck him, and he won't fuck his wife, and she's like, oh, maybe, and, but now he ignores her, and he's a shitty scientist, and they're making a female Viagra, and he's like, oh, I'm gonna make women wanna fuck me, but he's a shitty scientist, so he makes the worst thing ever, and they become kill crazy nymphos that attack, so now they have to make a cure, so no women will ever wanna fuck them.
It's a lot like Dead Hooker in the Trunk, the way that, with the title, you don't even need an explanation on what happens in it.
It's pretty solid.
Yeah, if I saw that in a comic show, I'd be like, yeah, I think that's for me.
It's a pretty extreme satire, but I always loved, like, Daniel Way created Dawkin, Wolverine's bisexual son, who had pheromone control powers, so he would make Bullseye question his sexuality.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, dude, and the fact that that was in mainstream Marvel, that's cool. Yeah. And he would seduce dudes all the time, and it was like, this is kind of cool to see it from a different angle. And his Deadpool was like so choice, so you can imagine how insane it is.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then there's a secret comic book that we're working on right now, which
secret?
Is it's an ongoing series with somebody you actually mentioned earlier in the interview, but I didn't say shit.
Oh, I know already.
Do you? Oh, no. But
we only mentioned one other comic writer. But anyway, you didn't know that. All right.
Yeah.
Moving on.
Yeah. It's cool. Something that got passed on as a TV show a few times. And
there's a lot of Easter eggs in this interview.
Yeah, exactly. Years later, this will be.
Turned into a,
2 years after this
year. I'll send you guys comics when it comes out. I'm very proud of it. And I'm very proud of how weird it is. And it's going to exist.
That's super cool. Well, we're glad that we were able to like line up schedules and make this happen. And really appreciate you coming out of your way to come to my weird
dude. Apartment. Just wanted to steal your Nirvana show.
I know, but that's not going
to
happen.
I just want to delicately touch.
I'm going to show the Nirvana stuff to Sylvia, but I'm going to keep an eye on her.
I'm wearing Nirvana socks. I'm so excited. Are you really? I am.
You guys know he was in the audience.
I know.
We're gonna talk about that. Right now.
That's nerdy.
I want you to mimic the hug that Kurt gave you.
Yeah.
Just kind of. All right. All there.
Walk them through it. Details.
And then Rebecca, we're going for drinks later.
Okay.
Really?
Good plan.
Yeah. I don't know.
We'll make sure we'll do.
We're ready to figure it out.
We'll figure it out.
If you guys are in town, we're gonna go do something.
I would love that.
Why aren't we doing the point live Point Break?
Yeah, that's exactly what we're doing.
Oh, we're doing live Point Break.
Wait, I'm gonna call Emma.
How about Hellevator?
You know, you guys are there anyway.
I'm going in tomorrow, and I'm gonna see if you guys can be the test team.
You guys need to be the test team.
Tell Turek. Turek will be great.
Tell Turek.
And I'm
writing
down live Point Break, and I'm gonna
live Point Break.
It's happening live. Live Point Break. Sounds even better. But I'll message you guys tomorrow. And
she's writing it in her notebook. I wish that you could see it. It's all just live Point Break written over and over again.
Over and over. Like an insane. Call Dad.
It's like a John Doe notebook.
Live Point Break. Call Dad.
Well, thank you so much for dropping by. We really appreciate it. And we'll see you guys next week.